I may like to say you all, the ICA annual conference will be on 17, 18, 19 December at Delhi, and we will be conducting it at Maulana Azad Medical College campus. You are welcome to that. Dr. Kirtiraj Saxena and Bharati Vadwan are the patients involved in the conduct. They are the organizing president and the organizing secretary, respectively. They will be writing to you all very soon about the conduct of the program and what will be the layout of the programs on every day. And this program will be joined by our associate groups or their associate groups, Society for Ambulatory Anesthesia of USA, also American Society of Anesthesiologists. They also will be participating in our annual conference. And as I said last time, we'll be having our winter edition of the newsletter ICA released sometime third week of September. And if anybody wants to contribute any article limited to 100 words, could be made available to us before 10th of September, so that we may, after the need editorial scrutiny, we'll try to include in the newsletter. And we are introducing many, many new innovations in our webinars. And one such is the debate, which is being widely appreciated. And if you find any particular mistake or any particular change or modification you want in the webinar or in the debate or anything new to be introduced in this academic program, you may kindly write to us telling which way we should go ahead. And now I formally open today's webinar. Today's webinar, as I said earlier, on certain areas in neuroanesthesia, and the conductor of the show are Dr. Padmaja Durga and Dr. Bibhu Kalyani Das. Dr. Padmaja Durga is the head of department and senior consultant anesthesiologist at Nizam's Institute of Medical Sciences, Panchakutta, Telangana, now Telangana, earlier Andhra Pradesh. And Padmaja Durga is known to you all well. She's one of the excellent teachers and neuroanesthetists. MSc is a teacher par excellence. And she has many publications to her credit, and she has written many number of textbooks for neuroanesthesia and other areas. Anyway, neuroanesthesia is one particular area very close to her. And she is more interested or spends more time even today in the neuroanesthesia areas. And she is a promoter of Indian Society of Anesthesiologists in Andhra Pradesh, both in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana now. And she is a well-going personality, mixes very well with them, and she is a real team leader. And she is ably helped today by Dr. Bibhu Kalyani Das, who also is known to you. And she also is a born neuroanesthetist. I may say that way, born neuroanesthetist, because the day I come to know Bibhu Kalyani Das, that is something like 35 years back, at that time itself, she is working in neuro areas. She is at present with an institution called the Institute of Neurosciences, and she is the director of the academics and the dean of Indian Society of Study of Pain. Because director of academics with that particular institute, and where she is the head of the department as well as a senior consultant in neuroanesthesia. But apart from that, she is the dean of our pain society, Indian Society for Study of Pain. Otherwise, we name it as Indian Academy of Pain Medicine. And apart from that, she was national president for the Pain Society of India, as well as the Neuroanesthesia Society of India. And she also is a promoter of ISA, and she was president of ISA West Bengal branch, as well as president of Critical Care Society, West Bengal branch. She is an editorial board member in most of the anesthesia connected journals of India. And she also is an author for many textbooks and has published many, many textbooks in the past and has won distinguished teacher award and many more such awards of the country. And both are going to moderate the topic of the day. And the topic of the day is on certain areas which most of you like to know much in details. And I request the moderators to introduce the speakers and the topic and start the program. And one thing more, the QA we are limiting to the end of the session. So all papers will be presented first, and the available time we'll utilize for question answer sessions. And if anybody wants to put up any question, they can put in the chat box. And if there are less number of questions, we will allow persons to speak directly to the speaker concerned. And if anybody wants an e-certificate, kindly register for the e-certificate now. And one thing more, apart from our program appearing on the YouTube other than this Zoom, today we have this particular projector through Anesthesia TV. Anesthesia TV, well, you know, one particular TV channel exclusively devoted for anesthesia presentations. And this particular channel controlled by Dubey. And Dubey is present. And I welcome Dr. Dubey also on this particular sessions. Dr. Dubey, please go ahead with Anesthesia TV. And I request Padmaja to take over.
Thank you, sir. First, thank you for your illustrious introduction. Neuroanesthesia, as we traditionally know, has been a bloody surgery and a very long surgery. But in the recent past, there is a paradigm shift in neurosurgery as well. There are more and more minimally invasive surgeries going on, and neuroendoscopic surgeries are one of those few. So with minimally invasive surgery, we understand that it's never minimal for an anesthetist. It may be minimal for the patient, a small incision and small pain, but then it's equally difficult for the surgeon and also difficult for the anesthetist. So we start our program with the topic on neuroendovascular procedures, which will be dealt with by Dr. Srilatha. And this brings us to the era of enhanced recovery after surgery. And this is applicable to neuroanesthesia as well. As I said, traditionally, neuroanesthesia or neurosurgery and neuroanesthesia were considered as something where the patient has to stay in the hospital for weeks together. But now we also look at enhanced recovery in neurosurgical procedures. And Dr. Monterio will be talking on the enhanced recovery and the anesthetic implications of that, or the anesthetic role of anesthesia also for that. And one of the major examination questions and also the practical problems for the neuroanesthetist is posterior fossa surgery, and it continues to provide challenges for us. And the most important thing is to understand the approaches of the surgeon, because these keep changing with this time. And Dr. Manikantan will be dealing with the approaches to the posterior fossa surgery and the implications for the anesthesiologist. So may I request Dr. Bibu Kalyani, madam, to introduce Dr. Srilatha.
Thank you, Padmaja, and thank you, Dr. Radhakrishnan, for those kind words. And I thank the ICA for arranging this neuroanesthesia in this webinar devoted to neuroanesthesia. As Padmaja said, that we have the issues which are coming up, and also we have the solutions which we can go for in neuroanesthesia. So the first speaker will be the endoscopic surgery and anesthesia in endoscopy, Dr. Srilatha. Can I have her CV on the screen, please? I know Srilatha is a very young and very energetic neuroanesthetist, and she's a teacher now. And I saw her from her MD days. From there, I know her. She's a brilliant student, and now she is a brilliant teacher also. So can I see the CV of Dr. Sinesh? Can you show me the CV of Dr. Srilatha? Dr. So Srijata is now at the additional professor at the Nizam Institute of Medical Sciences. She has authored research publications both in national and international journals, 16 publications and case reports, series of 6. And she authorized chapters in the neuroanesthesia books in 10 books. And she authorized review articles, 5 review articles. And she is going to speak on how what Dr. Padmaja said, that neuroendoscopy has made the lives of the neurosurgeons easier. They can visualize the part of the brain more vividly. And it's a minimally invasive procedure. And now, for the shunt surgery, we are not going for the VP shunt, which is so terrible. In our day, we used to see that they have to pass through the VP shunt. It's so terrible and so painful for the patient that sometimes you land up with many complications like your pneumothorax and all these things. So now they can do it in endoscopically, the third ventriculostomy. So this is becoming a routine procedure. And many areas of endoscopic, like endoscopically, they can go for the pituitary surgery, transpinedal pituitary, and many endoscopic surgery, even in the trigeminal neuralgia, they are approaching the microvascular decompression under endoscopy. So these are the things, and we'll hear from Srilata what the anesthetic challenges in this neuroendoscopic procedure. So I request Srilata to go for presentation. Srilata, please. Hello.
Hello. Hello, Dr. Srilata. You can continue.
Dr. Srinath, I'm audible to all of you?
Yes,
ma'am. I think she's muted. The host has to unmute Dr. Srilata.
Yeah. It's okay.
Yeah. Dr. Srilata, can kindly screen share again?
Yeah, that's right.
Yes.
Is it visible?
Yes. You can go to the slideshow. Yes.
Thank you, madam, for the kind introduction. And first of all, I would like to thank Padmaja ma'am, Balakrishna sir, and other members of the organizing committee of ICA for giving this platform for the presentation. My topic is anesthesia for neuroendoscopy. As we all know, I'll be dealing on these headings, the introduction and implications with different endoscopic procedures. History of neuroendoscopy, it dates back to Dr. Espinosa. He's a neurologist who was the first to perform a neuroendoscopic procedure. And later it was further refined by Dandy Walker and mixture. And with fiber optics and other advancements like flexible endoscopy and with the side channel aspirator, introducer seat for irrigation. Later, it has expanded to other neuroendoscopic procedures. Now, neuroendoscopy has established as a standard of care in neurosurgical procedures in most of the premium centers. So what are the different neurosurgical procedures which require this endoscopy, which can be done under endoscopy? One is that purely endoscopic surgeries, that is what we call as a channel endoscopy. That is the endoscope guided surgeries, was done usually via endonasal or port surgery. And the other one is the endoscope assisted microsurgeries. The purely endoscopic procedures include what the most common procedure undergone is a third ventriculostomy, and others like septostomy, aqueductoplasty, biopsies. And the endoscopic guided procedures include most endonasal, pituitary, and skull-based procedures, and the excision and biopsy of the interventricular tumors, marsupialization of the choroid cyst and arachnoid cyst, and even laser ablation of choroid plexus tumors and plexi. Looking around the corners, as in the case of schwannomas, then epidermoids, clipping of aneurysms, strip craniectomies, and spine surgeries. It also helps in aiding and confirming hemostasis in areas which cannot be easily approached without too much of brain retraction. This is usually the operation theater setup for any endoscopic surgical procedure. And most of the procedures, we as neuroanesthetists are usually placed on the left side of the OT table along with our workstations. And the other infrastructure, usually you have, apart from the personnel, you have the microscope, neuronavigation, and you have got the surgical aspirator unit, the cautery unit, and neuromonitoring if required for the procedure, and other instruments along with the endo unit. What are the advantages? If as anesthetists, if we can appreciate the value of a video laryngoscope over a traditional Macintosh laryngoscope, then we can appreciate the procedure of neurosurgical procedures done with endoscopy. So it gives a more precise and near complete to complete dissection and excision, a more closer anatomy of the surrounding vital structures. Hence, it carries very lesser morbidity and mortality. And as it's a minimally invasive, as we say, so it requires a smaller keyhole incision. So it is a cosmetic advantage. And because of the same smaller incisions, you have lesser blood loss. And you have decreased retraction because endoscope can maneuver inside for a proper, more clear anatomy. And you have got lesser hemodynamic fluctuations and also better hemostasis. Endoscopic third ventriculostomy is the most common neuroendoscopic procedure undergone. And you can see how the endoscope is placed. Usually a burr hole is done near the coronal. Coronal burr hole is made and it is passed. It enters first the lateral ventricle, and then through the foramen of Monroe, it enters the third ventricle. And usually perforation is made anterior to the mammillary bodies in the floor of the third ventricle, where a connection is done between the third ventricle and the prepontine cysts. This ETV has almost replaced the VP sans because it has very reduced incidence of post-op complications like infections and sun displacements. And the success rate almost ranges to 50 to 95% with reported mortality of almost less than 1%. These are the indications for ETV: symptomatic non-communicating hydrocephalus. This is important with a patent subarachnoid space, like acquired aqueductal stenosis, myelomeningocele, and posterior fossa tumors with obstructive hydrocephalus. The contraindications include history of meningitis, interventricular and subarachnoid hemorrhages, and if you don't have an inadequate subarachnoid space. Steps of ETV, as I already said, usually perforation is made in front of the mammillary bodies in the floor of the third ventricle. Through that transparent membrane, you can see the basilar artery. This is very important because vascular injuries are more common while doing this ETV. A fenestration is done, followed by serial dilatations, and the ETV procedure is done. Usually, the success is denoted by the free flap movement of the CSF through this connected channel. This shows the difference between how to go for ventriculostomy and also how to go for aqueductoplasty. This is the aqueductoplasty. You can see there's a aqueductal stenosis, and here serial dilatations were done to release the stenosis in the aqueduct. But here, it required a flexible neuroendoscope. So flexible neuroendoscope has taken over the fixed rigid neuroendoscope for this manner. What are the ideal goals for anesthesia management? As any craniotomy procedure, you need an immobile patient. And most important is monitoring of hemodynamics and CPP, especially to avoid the ischemic inserts. And for that, you need to be very meticulously monitored to detect and manage any fluctuations in the hemodynamics and maintain the CPP. So for the same purpose, we need to avoid any increase in ICP. And also, we require a rapid emergence from the procedure itself, soon after extubation mainly. So you have a prompt neurologic assessment as soon as the patient is extubated. And at the same time, we need to have minimize both the intra and postoperative complications by continuous monitoring of this hemodynamics and ICP. So coming to the choice of anesthesia, as I've already said, you need an immobile patient, so adequate depth of anesthesia and muscle relaxation is required. For maintenance, inhalational anesthesia of 0.5 to 1 mac is adequate. But at the same time, you should try to avoid further increase in mac to avoid the cerebral vasodilatory effects. Nitrous oxide is better avoided, not only for pneumocephalus, but also the chances of venous air embolism has been seen in some of the patients with ETV2, so better to avoid. And preferred analgesia, fentanyl, remifentanil, and again, rapid emergence, as I've said. The most important point to be noted, for though this ETV is a small procedure, so around 30 to 45 minutes, but to maintain the CPP is the main target. That at least it should be maintained more than 40. And for the same purpose, you need to have a proper maintenance of heart rate and blood pressure. And at the same time, you should avoid increase in ICP. Usually these channel endoscopic procedures, they are done under continuous irrigation. So this irrigation helps in adequate visualization of by expanding these collapsed ventricles. And also it maintains the pressure inside the neuroendoscope. This is very important, PIN. It should be maintained above the venous pressures to tamponade the venous and to some extent the arterial bleeding. And what is the choice of fluid for this irrigation in neuroendoscopic procedures? This is a Ringer's lactate at a temperature of 36 to 37 degrees centigrade, whose composition is almost quite close to CSF, and it has shown to have decreased incidence of complications. A lot of studies have been done for the same. Usually it's kept at a height of 100 centimeters. Other irrigating fluids which can be used, like normal saline, but normal saline has shown to have a lot of complications like postoperative increase in body temperature, delayed awakening, dyselectrolytemia, and changes in CSF composition. And at the same time, studies have shown that the volume of normal saline is more deleterious rather than the duration of the procedure. So even 500 ml of normal saline was shown to be deleterious. Another important point to be noted, that the outflow channel, which is there, it should not be closed or kinked to avoid any hazardous increase in the ICP. And nowadays, because of the side effects of these irrigating fluids, most of the surgeons say advocate limited to no use of irrigating solutions wherever required. So coming to the monitoring, as I said, though this ETV is a short procedure, but it has got beat and beat measurement of the heart rate is very, very important. Apart from the basic monitoring like saturation and ETCO2 and ECG. Arterial blood pressure, obviously, it gives us, apart from the beat-to-beat measurement, you can have monitoring of the glucose and the electrolyte status and the ABG status. If the patient, usually in the post-op period, if the patient has delayed awakening, you can go for monitoring of this ABG status and accordingly manage the case. And the PIN, I already said, it is a surrogate monitor for ICP in these procedures. And the reliability of this PIN is increased if this sensor is placed at the distal end of the rinsing channel. And other alternative techniques for ICP monitoring is TCD and telemetric medicine, which has been used in some of the cases. And because most of the patients are pediatric and irrigation fluid has been used. So again, continuous core body temperature monitoring is very important. Apart from that, urine output monitoring along with electrolytes guides the fluid management part. Even for monitoring for VAE, TEE and Doppler, if is there available, you can use. And for depth of anesthesia, BIS or entropy monitoring is helpful. Coming to this important part, that is complications. The cardiac disturbances are very common, and both brady and tachyarrhythmias are seen. Bradycardia and hypertension usually it occurs because there'll be stretching of the preoptic area during perforation of the floor of the third ventricle. And the other one, tachycardia and hypertension. These tachyarrhythmias are more common than bradycardia. And usually if tachycardia occurs with hypertension, this is called the atypical Cushing's response. Usually when whenever there is increased ICP, expected bradycardia along with increased BP. But here in ETV, during ETV procedure, you get a typical Cushing's response because of this ischemic event. And tachycardia is mainly attributed to compression of the posterior hypothalamus due to the dilated third ventricle. And hypertension occurs due to the high-speed fluid irrigation or due to the kinking of the outflow tube. So maintaining normothermia with a controlled rate of irrigation at 10 ml per minute with proper and adequate drainers of irrigation are important requisites to prevent these cardiac disturbances. As I've already said, hypokalemia and hypernatremia, there's a dyselectrolytemia is more common with normal saline irrigation along with acidosis. With Ringer's lactate irrigation, hypokalemia can also see. And hypothermia, as I said, is again a common complication. And it can be avoided to some degree with use of inline drainage system and with pre-warmed irrigation fluids and warm blankets. Another major complication seen in around 30 to 40% of the cases, massive upward ballooning of the floor of the third ventricle. This is a surgical complication, but still is a common complication which occurs. And the other one is a vascular injury. As I've already said, when you go for perforation of the floor of the third ventricle, you can see the basilar artery on the other side. So the chances of injury, basilar artery injury is more common. And if it occurs, it's just disastrous and it leads to massive blood loss and sometimes to cardiac arrest. So you need to be very, very meticulous. Obviously the surgeon needs to be very meticulous, and at the same time, the immobile patient plays an important role at this juncture. Again, the incidence of VA is also seen and is around 0.35 to 4%. And you need to be very careful again in the management of such incidents. Other rare but disastrous injuries can occur to paraventricular structures like fornix, basal ganglia, and hypothalamus and brainstem. And other complications are usually related to positioning and specific complications related to the pathodiagnosis. Even some post-operative complications I've seen. These are the list of complications. I'm not going into the detail because I'll be dealing with other neuroendoscopic procedures with anesthetic complications. Next is the endoscopic tumor excision or the cyst fenestration. This is mainly what we call as the endoscopic guided ventricular tumor excision or fenestration, cyst fenestrations. The indications are interventricular tumors of second or third ventricle with soft consistency, less than 2 to 3 with moderate to low vascularity, with associated hydrocephalus or of low grade histologically. These are the types of masses which usually are dealt with: polyoid cysts, subependymal giant cell astrocytomas, ixophytic low grade gliomas, choroid plexus tumors, interventricular craniopharyngiomas, pineal tumors, and interventricular cysts. This is the case of choroid plexus plexitis, where there'll be an abundance of CSF production leading to increased ICP. So here, this thulium laser has been used for ablation of this choroid plexus. And such type of cases where laser is used, you need to be careful for the anesthetic implications, like better to go for laser resistant tracheal tubes and proper meticulous monitoring, and need to be careful if there is an airway fire. You need to be very careful at, and how to manage the airway fire. Fire is an important part of the management. And another thing, this thulium laser is very, very has played a very important role in most of the recent cases. It goes for a very smooth incision with better hemostasis in most of the cases. The bleeding is very, very less with this thulium laser. And other cases like pineal tumors and tumors associated with hydrocephalus, it can further go for sampling of the tumor and sampling of CSF markers. Next, I'll going for the endoscopic guided assisted skull-based surgeries. Again, we have seen that these endoscopic surgeries are minimally invasive with maximal assertiveness. And the key requisites, like you need to select a proper surgical corridor that causes minimal manipulation of the surrounding structures and reduces the risk of complications. So here, the neuronavigation plays an important role in identifying the surgical approach. But contraindications, you should always be aware of, that is involvement of optic canal and encasement of the third cranial nerve. There's a different types of approach for this, like extended endoscopic and endoscopic endonasal approach for mainly for pituitary gland and other tumors. Endoscopic supraorbital approach, mainly for the tumors of the anterior cranial fossa, and endoscopic retrosigmoid approach for the tumors of the posterior cranial fossa. We are all aware of the traditional endonasal transsphenoidal hypophysectomy. The indications are almost same even for the endoscopic endonasal approach. There's the pituitary neoplasms like pituitary adenomas, and mainly for the tumors, both for micro and macro adenomas, even for the hyperfunctioning, even for craniopharyngiomas. The same anesthetic implications goes, just like if you're placing a lumbar drain, if you're going for a valve maneuver, the same anesthetic implications follow for the endoscopic procedure too. So what are the advantages? So you have minimal to no dissection of the turbinates with lesser hemodynamic perturbations and with the lesser incidence of injury to the optic chiasma and frontal lobes. So there is even a lesser incidence of diabetes insipidus, cosmetically more acceptable with a clear surgical view and a shorter hospital stay with lesser morbidity and minimal postoperative pain. Other implications, airway. This is very important. The airway is said right now because this is an endonasal procedure. So airway is said, so you need to be very careful about thinking of the tube and placement of the airway. Of the ET tube, fixing of the ET tube is very important. Throat pack again is a very important prerequisite for this procedure and documentation for the same. Endotracheal tubes, usually we go for portets, but flexometallic tubes if is also preferred. Better to go for south pole RE tubes. Hemodynamic fluctuations are common, but obviously very less compared to the traditional approach. And for the same, you can go for intraorbital or maxillary blocks. If there is a vascular injury, again, the chances of carotid artery injury and cavernous sinus injury is common, so need to be dealt accordingly. And important thing is that nasal packing is not required in these cases, so the chances of negative pressure pulmonary edema is avoided. This is a case you can see, and most of the 70% of the tumor was medial to the cavernous carotid and 30% to the lateral cavernous carotid. So you can see they have used Doppler along with this endoscopy to delineate the carotid artery. So they have nicely excised the tumor, both lateral and medial to the carotid artery. This is again a case of CSF rhinuria, and they've used neuronavigation along with the endoscopy for the repair of this CSF rhinuria. Next, coming to the endoscopy-assisted tumor excision, this is again, there is a supraorbital key incision which has been given for this case for the excision of craniopharyngeum. You can see the cosmetic acceptability for the case. pre-anesthetic checkup is almost same as we go for any traditional approach, but we need to understand that if the same thing applies, but you need to like that the lesser post-operative pain. And if you are using specific neuromonitoring, you need to guide the anesthesia drugs accordingly. And there may be chances of vascular injury depending on the site of the tumor. So accordingly, we need to have our IV fluid management and blood transfusions. This is again important. Supraorbital approach usually involves some amount of muscle dissection, but it does not disrupt the sensory nerve. So muscle relaxation is not contraindicated. And here, again, usually physiological monitoring is not necessary for these type of cases. And the other thing is armored endotracheal tubes and oral girdle airways are better to prevent biting of the tube at the time of neurophysiological monitoring. And again, this is important. If it is an endoscopic retrosigmoid approach, then park bench position is usually required, and which is a very challenging position for the anesthetist. Chances of vascular injury is there because it is a keyhole surgery. So if there is any vascular injury, conversion to open procedure and control of the blood loss is very, very challenging. So last bore cannulas must, even though it is a keyhole procedure. Okay? And it carries the same amount of intraoperative and postoperative complications. This is the endoscopic, the other important in pediatric patients they usually do is endoscopic strip craniectomies. This is usually done for craniosynostosis patients. The incidence of craniosynostosis is around 0.4 per 1,000 births, and usually is done in syndromic craniosynostosis patients. These are the different types of craniosynostosis. This remodeling technique, usually it involves more than a simple strip craniectomy through a small endoscopic port, and it requires safe dissection at the level of subgaleal in the epidural structures, thus limiting the blood loss compared to the open technique. And usually preferred in young infants less than 4 months of age. And at this stage, the calvarial bones are very thin and therefore they can be easily cut with the endoscopic cyst. And this also decreases the blood loss because they're very less cancellous and the space between the two tables of the skull is not well developed. These are the pics, images of the endoscopic strip craniectomy. So what are the advantages? So obviously shorter operative time, and there'll be drastic reduction in the blood loss, thus fewer transfusion requirements, and obviously a shorter hospital stay. Overall reduction in the cost associated with lower morbidity and mortality. Like any other traditional craniosynostosis repair, so you need to have a proper pre-anesthetic checkup for the patient. You need to evaluate and exclude all the syndromes for this patient or a difficult airway and accordingly take care of the same. And again, adequate vascular access for immediate transfusion in place of acute blood loss. Positioning is again vital for this group of patients along with other monitoring, and also hypothermia is common because it's a pediatric patient. The hypothermia is again common. You can see here for the endoscopic strip craniectomy, the different steps along with the position of the child in prone. Ongoing blood loss is a very, very important concern in small infants. So what we usually advocate is if the patient's HP, as such in Indian patients, most of the patients are better to go for a transfusion the start of the procedure itself. So you give an infusion form and maintained infusion dosage. And at the same time, if there is a acute blood loss, you try to avoid hyperkalemia in these patients, because this is the you need to maintain the hyperkalemia and the blood loss in this group of patients. When there is blood loss, acute blood loss, you need to push the blood. So when you're pushing the blood, again, hyperkalemia. So you need to balance that. So very, very important step for most of the pediatric patients are doing craniosynostosis surgery. Blood conservation techniques, if available, use of tranexamic acid is helpful. Again, as I said, venous air embolism is also common in these patients. So you need to be very careful in monitoring and management of these cases, because usually we have seen that even at the time of closure also these patients may land up with venous air embolism. So very, very, we need to be very careful in monitoring and management. Other complications is almost equivalent to the traditional approach. The other one is endoscopic assisted clipping of aneurysms. And the aneurysms that are amenable, both the anterior and the post-circulation aneurysms. And actually with the endoscope, it gives a very clear vision of the regional anatomy of the aneurysm and its neck, and also identifies the perforators and precisely verifies the optimal position of the clip. And because of its increased illumination and magnification, it gives a very, very clear picture of the surroundings of the aneurysm and the dead corners. Fischer et al. Described the relevant use of endoscope for clipping of cerebral aneurysms. And the approaches like supraorbital approach for anterocranial fossa aneurysms and endoscopic endonasal approach for the middle cranial fossa aneurysms. The complications are almost of the same, but again, rupture of aneurysm is a very challenging situation if it is a keyhole surgery. So again, managing, if it is a massive blood loss, managing the rupture is a very, very, what we say, you need to be very, very careful. So you need to have a proper management of the pressures during the endoscopy assisted clipping of aneurysms. So you can't be careless while manipulating the BP in these cases. The other complications are same, the neurovascular injuries and dorsal distal pointers as any other traditional approach. Finally, coming to the spinal procedures, endoscopic spinal procedures requires very little muscle and other structural dissection. So you have minimal postoperative pain that allows early recovery and mobilization. And accordingly, you have lesser operating time, reduced incidence of bleeding, and a significant decrease in the hospital stay. Less operating time, I won't say for the initial learners, but later you'll have a less operating time. And nowadays, they're performed in combination with use of the stereotactic and neuronavigation systems with fluoroscopic guidance and tubular retractors. And just it reduces the working distance and enhances the safety of the procedure. These are the different surgical procedures which are undertaken with endoscopy. And this is the endoscopic microdiscectomy, which usually is a common spinal procedure which is done. You can see the clear anatomy of the prolapsed disc, which is removed out. Again, implications are almost the same for any spine procedures, but you need to have overall, there will be decreased incidence of complications like respiratory complications and blood loss and minimal postoperative pain. But if you're using a DLT and you want to do some neuromonitoring, you need to be very careful because DLT is a used tube. So you need to attenuate the cuff reflex with proper adequate depth of anesthesia with use of propofol, remifentanil, and other alternative drugs which can be used are dexam and methohexital. Coming to advances in neuroendoscopy, what are the implications? Robotic assisted neuroendoscopy has shown some promising results. And the advantages include a lesser radiation exposure and user-friendly, but at the same time, it is quite cumbersome. So while positioning these patients and securing the airway with longer hoses and intravenous tubings, so you need to be very careful for anesthesia and management per se. You need to be very meticulous and very for these robotic procedures. These are all other advances in endoscopy, like Nicomediate. This is mainly for the site tissue surgical aspirators, which are used mainly for the excision of the ventricular tumors. They have good hemostasis and other flexible arthroscopy, suture passage closure of the lumbar fascia. It's mainly for it minimizes the pain and also decreases the incidence of bleeding. And already I've shown you the use of laser and TCD is mainly to decrease the incidence of the vascular injury and also decrease the incidence of bleeding with thulium laser. They are shown to be very, very effective. These are my references. Thanks. Thanks for the patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Srilata. That was a wonderful presentation. The next topic is on enhanced recovery in neurosurgery and the anesthetic modifications that we need to do to facilitate this. As we have seen, the neuroendoscopic procedures and the minimally invasive procedures pave the way for enhanced recovery in neurosurgery as well. And in the last decade, we've seen a significant emphasis on enhanced recovery in all fields of surgical procedures, and neurosurgery is not far behind in this. So let us hear from Dr. Joseph about enhanced recovery in neurosurgery and the implications or the modifications that the anesthesiologist has to do for this. May I request Dr. Bibu Kalyani Das to introduce our esteemed speaker, Dr. Joseph Mehta.
Thank you, Padmaja, for giving this opportunity. Dr. Joseph Materio is known to this platform. I think everybody knows him, but I'll have the pleasure and privilege to introduce him to this audience. He's a consultant neuroanesthesiologist, program director of the Dr. N.V. Neuroanesthesia and Neurocritical Care at the P.D. Hinduja Hospital and of the Medical Research Center, Mumbai. And his affiliations are many affiliations, like Scientific Research Committee member of P.D. Hinduja Hospital and Research Center, and Editorial Board member, reviewer, Journal of Neuroanesthesiology and Critical Care, reviewer of Journal of Anesthesiology and Clinical Pharmacology, reviewer, Indian Journal of Anesthesia, reviewer, PLOS1, and accredited PG teacher diplomat of the National Board of Examinations, Neuroanesthesiology and Anesthesiology. His qualification and certified training and MD fellowship in neuroanesthesia and neurocritical care at the Addenbrooke's Hospital, Cambridge University, UK. And he has many awards and scholarships, GN Tata Endowment Scholar, 1997-98, Hinduja Cambridge Trust for Scholarship, Hinduja Foundation, UK, 1998, Jamsetji Tata Scholarship, 1997-98, Cambridge Society Bombay Scholarship, 1998-99, Ratan Tata Travel Fellowship, 1993, and many more. He has many publications, and to his credit. So now he's going to deliver his talk on the role of anesthesiologists in eras for neurosurgical anesthesia. So neurosurgical procedures, eras is also has come to this thing, but we have very little, I think he will tell us, very little work or the review literature in this eras in neurosurgery. So let us hear from the expert, our Dr.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr.
So,
thank
so
you, Dr.
I'll request you. Okay.
Thank you, Dr.
Kindly.
Thank you, madam. And thank you, Dr. Padmaja. So today, my topic for discussion is the role of the anesthesiologist in ERAS for neurosurgical procedures. So I thought over the next 25 minutes, I sort of discuss thoughts and also review the literature and try to help us redefine our roles as we move into this era of ERAS in neuroanesthesia. So now, Alvin Toffler was a great American futurist, businessman, academician. And I love this quote of his where he said, the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. So here, all of us engaged in neuroanesthesia are trying to strive for excellence and trying to improve our techniques and gather more skills and improve our protocols to sort of make things better and also give better patient outcomes. So I saw this initial report in 2015 coming from UCLA saying value-based neurosurgery. So there are a lot of nomenclatures available in the literature, but I found this was a very interesting thing where they studied at UCLA, they studied patients undergoing microvascular decompression, and they sort of made a dashboard of the patients who admitted over a three-year period starting from April 2013 to August 2015-16, and the length of stay for brain tumor patients. So we can see here the lower grayish line showing you the lower estimate of expected values, and the upper grayish line showing the upper limit of expected values. And the middle blue line shows you what they recorded in their patients. And in the lower part of the panel, you can see the inpatient tumor resection, surgery, and hospitalization, the direct variable cost. And we can see the fluctuation over time as they implemented certain procedures. So now ERAS is also a part of a multi-centric, multi-systemic, multidisciplinary implementation of protocols. So they also recorded that in the last 6 months, the percentages of patients who helped reach early mobility and achieving all four goals. Now they defined four goals. The first goal was sitting upright in bed at the bedside for 5 minutes at 10 p.m. on the day of the surgery. The goal two was walking 4 feet, 5 feet to the chair and sitting in the chair for 5 minutes by 9 a.m. on the post-op day one. And the goal three was ambulating 50 feet with the help of a nurse by 12 p.m. on the post-op day one. And you can see as we go on further, and as these rules were, systems were implemented, more patients, means almost 60% of patients achieved all these four goals as per their initiative. And this is a nice dashboard showing the extract of microvascular decompression syndrome program dashboard. And you can see the inpatient surgery admissions, how it fluctuated over that period. Discharge non-home setting after surgery, 30-day return to OR, 30-day readmission, 30-day ED visits, and surgery admission versus direct variable cost. Now, no talk about ERAS can be started unless we remember Professor Kehlet, and he introduced this concept of enhanced recovery after surgery in 1997. ERAS protocols have gained wide acceptance in a wide variety of surgical subspecialties. And ERAS today has gone way beyond perioperative care protocols. They even have a website, www.erassociety.com, in 2010 onwards. And the ERAS Society has developed evidence-driven guidelines for multidisciplinary perioperative pathways. So I went into this article. It's a mini review by Aliza Abelis and Ara Darzi in the World Journal of Gastrointestinal Surgery. Now, Professor Kehlet's work first started off in gastrointestinal surgery. So this is in 2017. So very interestingly, they see in this table here, the Enhanced Recovery After Surgery Society recommendations for colonic surgery and the evidence levels. So the ERAS element with high to moderate evidence level was stopping smoking 4 weeks prior to surgery, no routine use of sedative pre-medication, antimicrobial prophylaxis, and coming to the anesthesiologist role, balanced intravenous fluid guided by flow measurements. And of course, in gastrointestinal surgery, use of mid-thoracic epidural and use of spinal analgesia. And the ERAS elements they defined with low level of evidence was preoperative information and counseling, stopping drinking alcohol 4 weeks prior and such. Now, very interestingly, this talk that has been given is to define the role of, or to examine the role of the neuroanesthesiologist in ERAS. So now very often we realize that as anesthesiologists, we sort of focus very much on the work that we do in the operation theater. And all of us here, I think on this forum are doing a very good job already. And some of them are learning to do this job well. So now we see here in this, you can see here on the key, the beige color key shows you the intervention that is done, and the blue color key shows you the measurements that were performed. So now what they did is they used the physical activity monitoring in the perioperative period, and multiple opportunities exist, they said, for implementation of activity monitors in the perioperative period. So in the preoperative period, monitored prehabilitation preoperatively. So what you do is you measure the baseline activity of the patient, you assess the patient for surgical fitness, And you also predict the post-operative operative support that you may require. Now, the small diamond you see is the surgical part where the anesthesiologist, we already know the role. And in the hospital, post-surgery, monitoring the early mobilization, patient feedback and motivation, early detection of complications, a safe hospital discharge. Now, one thing we must know is we are so focused on the good work we do in the operation theater that I think as anesthesiologists, to define our role, we have to take a step back and have a look at the broader picture. And ultimately, what we do for the patient is, of course, a safe outcome and to return that patient well to the community. So once again, we move to the community, re-establishing baseline activity, maintaining health and well-being in the community, and measuring long-term functional outcome. So rather than being very focused onto the intraoperative part, maybe as anesthesiologists, we can sort of refocus our attention to a broader picture. ERAS in neurosurgery, the protocols are currently being established, and owing to rapid worldwide development of neurosurgery in recent decades, minimally invasive craniotomy has benefited a huge number of patients with improved recovery and satisfaction. Many of our colleagues abroad, like in Canada and many other places, they have daycare surgeries for aneurysm, though we have not yet reached that level yet. These protocols have consistently been shown to decrease the length of stay by 2 to 3 days, the cost of hospitalization, rehospitalization, and perioperative complications by 30 to 50% while improving patient satisfaction. In 2016, in the Journal of Clinical Neurosciences, Hagen et al. Published this work of enhanced recovery after surgery after oncological craniotomies. Now see the date, it is 2016, February. And Hagen et al. Used a great criteria for providing best practice recommendations based on current evidence in a systematic review. And what they did is, of the initial 551 patients that they retrieved, only 67 patients were relevant, 28 were RCTs, 16 were systematic reviews of meta-analysis, 8 were prospective, and 6 were retrospective cohort studies. And they summarized that for most of the interventions that they reviewed, although they make intuitive sense, the level of evidence ranged from low to moderate. The final product presented recommendations related to 17 domains, pre, intra, and post-operative care. So these are the domains that Hagen et al. Suggested in the pre-operative phase, pre-operative counseling, alcohol and smoking cessation, nutritional status and immunonutrition, anti-thrombotic profile axis. In the intraoperative phase, antimicrobial prophylaxis, fluid and hemodynamic management, perioperative antibiotics, scalp block, total intravenous anesthesia preferred, general anesthesia, longer versus shorter acting opioids, they were discussed, and surgical techniques, they suggested minimally invasive and avoidance of hypothermia. In the postoperative period, postoperative analgesia using non-opioids, NSAIDs, gabapentin, pregabalins, postoperative nausea and vomiting treatment, early mobilization, avoidance of hypothermia, early postoperative nutrition, once again, early mobilization, and early removal of the Foley's catheter. In this article, experience with fast-track postoperative care after deep brain stimulation by Nuria Martin et al. It is from Barcelona, Spain. The author studied the 24-hour stay in a post-anesthesia care unit, which is a common practice after deep brain stimulation surgery, and they evaluated the impact of a fast-track protocol in these kind of patients. And their study included 19 patients who underwent deep brain stimulation surgery. The conclusion of this group was a fast-track discharge protocol is a safe and post-operative care after DBS, and there are a small percentage of complications after DBS, which mainly occur in the first 6 hours. Now, we in Hinduja, we do deep brain stimulation surgery, but we keep our patients overnight in a high dependency unit or in the ICU, and we don't transfer the patients out so fast, and we discharge the patient after 2 days after the procedure. This is an interesting super selective scalp block to help in as an integral part of enhanced recovery after neurosurgery. This is a study done by David Fersen et al. From MD Anderson in the US. and 37 patients in their study who underwent the super selective scalp block, which provided scalp anesthesia for the entire procedure. And they said its opioid sparing effects make it a very attractive technique as a part of ERAS in neurosurgery, and it warrants further investigation. Now, friends and colleagues and our peers from All India Institute of Medical Sciences, Rajiv Mishra, Indu Kapoor, Charu Mahajan, and Himanshu Prabhakar wrote this excellent review article, "From an Indian Perspective, Enhanced Recovery After Surgery, a Neuroanesthetic Perspective." This was in 2017. And the last line which I've highlighted says, "The article reviewed the various aspects of ERAS and its implementation in neurosurgical practice. And they said that some of the concept of ERAS may not be applicable in the setting of neurosurgery." In the Journal of Journal of Neurosurgical Spine in 2017, Michael Wang et al. They published this article, "Development of Enhanced Recovery After Surgery, the ERAS Approach After Lumbar Spinal Fusion." And they concluded that it's good in spinal fusion surgeries. And they said that it is provides a more patient-focused approach and reducing the stress of operation. And they suggested some iterative improvement processes. Now, let me warn you that these patients were done, they were minimally invasive spine surgeries. They were done with the patient away with local anesthesia and MAC. So the anesthesia protocol, they have said no general anesthesia recommended, long-acting opioids have to be avoided, and proper short duration sedation may be required. And the other role of the anesthetist, they said intraoperative maintenance of normothermia, blood pressure as routinely performed. Fluid balance, they suggested non-invasive cardiac output monitoring as for minimally invasive monitoring of the fluid status during the operation, and hypovolemia should be avoided. And to go on, they compared these are the graphs of insulin sensitivity and tissue damage in their patients, the undergoing spinal ERAS procedures and traditional surgery. You can see the blue line remaining near normal as compared to the traditional surgery. And these were the iterative components which they suggested. And this suggested there were no anesthetic complications, pain control depended upon, they use liposomal bupivacaine injection, which we don't have yet. And they suggested continuation of propofol ketamine protocol and injection of bupivacaine under high pressure for all screw tracks. This article in World Neurosurgery by Neha Dangayach et al., "Enhanced Recovery After Neurosurgery, a Paradigm Shift and a Call to Arms." Once again, they have suggested their domains, preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative, and they have added some new components to this. They said preoperative comprehensive geriatric assessments with the geriatricians, perioperative pharmacological and non-pharmacological pain management, patient-centered decision-making tools for surgery, 3D stimulation for preoperative planning, and once again, this key word, prehabilitation, remote monitoring of activity levels at home. So at the home itself, you identify the functional status of the patient, because that is what you want him to go back to and probably get better. Pre-admission counseling, and intraoperatively, they have suggested seizure prophylaxis and expectant complex extubation plans to prevent re-intubation. So if it's a difficult intubation, you make your plan preoperatively itself. And understanding the variabilities in steroid dosing and tapering, and postoperatively, brain management, DVT prophylaxis, seizure prophylaxis, early mobilization is what they suggested. And another important part they suggested here is compliance and audits. So whenever we do our work, the only way we can get better is by auditing our own work, auditing the processes and systems in place, and some sort of a feedback mechanism so that where the protocols already in place can be tweaked to get better results. And this article by Enhanced Recovery After Spine Surgery, a review of the literature by Marco Cornolia et al. This sort of literature reviewed the studies on ERAS in spine surgery, and they too suggested their own domains, the preoperative, intraoperative, and the postoperative period. So a lot of work is going on. In this interesting article, a neurosurgical enhanced recovery after surgery program for elective craniotomy. So now once here we are getting a study in craniotomies, Are the patients satisfied with the experiences, a quantitative and a qualitative analysis by Bolin Liu et al.? So here we have what they did is they had a single center prospective randomized controlled study in a tertiary hospital in China, 140 neurosurgical patients aged between 18 to 65 years had a single intracranial lesion admitted for craniotomy. And they implemented the ERAS protocol in 70 patients and the traditional non-ERAS protocol in the other 70 patients. And they measured the outcomes. So what is very interesting is, you know, the feedback of the people. There's a saying in Latin, vox populi vadio. If you hear the voice of the people, you can hear the voice of God. That will help you to improve yourself. So now here, this is an interesting quote of the patients. So the first one says, well, you know, it's a good thing, but there's simply too much of information out there. As I said to myself, okay, let me just follow the doctors and the nurses and let them tell me what to do next. I'll follow the instructions as long as I know they mean good. And another person says, you signed the consent and made a commitment. You're obliged to stay strong and comply with the rules. He said that the patient number 40 said there was a lot of pressure on me. And another patient said, a nurse came in and shouted, how come you're still in bed? You don't have any IV fluids. Come on now, try to walk. But the patient is saying, I already walked and I even walked 2 rounds in the corridor earlier this morning. She didn't come early enough to see that. I'm not a soldier to follow the rigid instructions as to when to do what. That is patient number 15. So that's very, see now, we may be obsessed with trying to make our protocols succeed, but we must also see what the feedback of the patient. And this is another patient saying that the cell phone app worked much better than the phone call. So they had an app where they could give in their feedback and they could get in touch with their doctor, because normally phoning in to the doctor makes it very difficult because the doctors are very busy. So this patient says on the third day, he had a funny feeling around the wound and there was a small lump next to the wound. And then the son took a picture of the cell phone and sent it to the doctor and the doctor helped him out. So this is another research article, successful implementation of enhanced recovery after surgery protocol, reducing nausea and vomiting after infratentorial craniotomy for tumor resection by Dan Liu. And I won't go into great detail, but I'll just tell you the conclusion. Successful implementation of the ERAS protocol in infratentorial craniotomy patients could attenuate post-operative anxiety, improve sleep quality, and reduce the incidence of PONV without increasing the rate of post-operative complications. And yet another article here, research paper by Liang Wu. I'll get to all these articles later in my talk. Management of post-operative pain after elective craniotomy, a prospective randomized controlled trial of neurosurgical enhanced recovery program. And they concluded here that the implementation of neurosurgical ERAS for elective craniotomies has significant benefits in alleviating post-operative pain and enhancing recovery, leading to early discharge as compared to conventional care. However, they also caution further evaluation of this protocol in larger multi-center studies is warranted. So here we can see a little bit of the results. So ERAS group 64, control group 65, the parameters examined a post-operative fever in 9 patients in the ERAS group. I will only focus on the ERAS group. Post-operative seizure, 3 in the ERAS group, renal craniotomy, mental status change, diabetes, insipidus, none. Post-operative blood sugar levels, more than 200 in 4 of the ERAS patients. Nausea and vomiting, use of antiemetics in 10 out of the 64 patients. And as compared to, now what I want to stress is that, if you are one of those 9 patients, how distressing could be for you? Understood. So for you, this may just be a number, 9, 3, 10, and a readmission, even if it's 1 within 2 weeks of discharge, can be quite disconcerting to the patient and the relatives. And this is a monitored anesthesia care combined with scalp nerve block in awake craniotomy, an effective attempt at enhanced recovery after neurosurgery by Yan Jun Chen. And 20 procedures they have done. And they conclude applying a ERANS protocol was feasible, associated with low incidence of complications and acceptable intensive care unit and post-operative hospital length of stay. The finding of the current study may provide a new approach for further research on ERANS. So now I can see here what they have done is, what are the components of what they did? Early post-operative feeding and exercise, stricter discharge standards, extensive preoperative counseling, strict protocol-based medical and nursing care, shortened two-hour fluid fast, perfect intraoperative monitoring, ultrasound-guided nerve block, monitored anesthesia care, goal-directed fluid therapy, no indwelling catheter. So they put diapers for all their patients, and they prevented hypothermia, and they prevented nausea and vomiting. And in those cases where they put an arterial line, they applied 5% compound lidocaine cream for the radial artery puncture and covered with this transparent dressing. And here you can see they have done a USG-guided scalp nerve block. And maybe this is one area we can sort of improve the scalp nerve block as we do it. And next we come to this article, a clinical study by Pratik Agarwal, Ilya Frid from the University of Pittsburgh. It is like a multi-center. What they did is they did a questionnaire-based survey among all the other institutions from Salzburg, Austria, Rochester, USA, and Baltimore, USA, and Grand Rapids, USA. So they sent a questionnaire across and they saw the responses. So now in figure one, you can see out of the 39 survey responses, 23 individuals reported utilizing ERAS at the institution and 16 reported not using ERAS. And you can see in the surgical disciplines where the ERAS protocol is applied, 23 were in spine, much fewer in cranial, and even fewer in others, and many were not used at all. And from the graph on the lower part of the panel, of those, a majority were multidisciplinary protocols, fewer were institution-based protocols, very few were independent protocols, and 7.1% were departmental protocols. Once again, you see interestingly here, academic and non-academic institutions and their contributions to implementing ERAS. So the darker bars are showing the academic people who are using it, and the lighter bar shows you the non-academic institutions implementing the ERAS protocols. Now, very, very interestingly, I followed up with my dear friend Himanshu Prabhakar, and they have this letter to the editor where they have done a review, systematic review. This art is not yet published, and I just managed to get it from him. So what they did is, and they have very clearly said that after Hagen's article, there was a knowledge gap for ERAS patients undergoing ERAS protocols in oncological craniotomies. So what they did is they took out the records and using the PRISMA guidelines, they analyzed all the data available in the literature. And finally, the three studies included in the qualitative analysis were all, as I mentioned, single center trials with the same intervention and comparator groups. Lower down in the panel, you can see a forest plot of the length of stay and the confidence interval showing those patients who underwent ERAS and those that were favoring the control. But very interestingly, the findings of their review suggest that ERAS-based approach is not superior to conventional management in patients undergoing craniotomy as compared to the conventional management. This is going to be published in Journal of Neurosurgical Anesthesiology in this year, in the coming months. Now I'll come to Avedis Dolabedian. He was an Armenian physician who took a lot of interest in healthcare and quality control measures in healthcare and improving quality in healthcare. So the Donabedian model still reigns, exists because he introduced the model of structure, process, and outcome. You can see here it's a linear sort of model where first the physical and organizational characteristics where healthcare occurs are studied. Then you implement the process, which is a focus on the care delivered to the patient, like services or treatments. In this case, it could be ERAS. And then you look at the outcomes and the effect of the healthcare on the status of the patient and the population after implementing that intervention. Now, the Donabedian model is very good, but if you can see, it's linear, so there's no feedback mechanism to try to recorrect if anything is not working that well. So probably the model should be structure, process, and outcome, where there is auditing of work, studying of the various literature, and then we can give a better outcome to our patients. And I like this quote of Professor Avedis Donabedian, where he says, systems awareness and systems design are important for health professionals, but they are not enough. They are enabling mechanisms only. It is the ethical dimensions of individuals that are essential to a system's success. And ultimately, he says, the secret of quality is love. So I'll conclude by saying there is a need for better understanding, better standardizing, consensus building of multimodal pathways for optimizing perioperative care in elective neurosurgeries. Dedicated pathways have the potential to reduce stay and cost of hospitalization and improve functional outcomes and patient satisfaction after elective cranial and spinal procedures. Further assessment of ERAS protocols in neurosurgery by multicentric trials is the way forward. And as Carl Jung said, for better to come, good must stand aside. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Monterio, for that excellent lecture on ERAS in neurosurgery. So now we have to go further. So the evidence which are coming up, what you discussed, that something is there, there are debates on that using ERAS. Sometimes it is better, some people say that it is not better for elective and neurosurgical operations, because you said that in oncosurgery, maybe it is better and we can go for that. So many issues are there for neurosurgical anesthesia. It is different from other anesthesia, the gastroenterology, gastroenterological anesthesia. So we are there. It is early part of our ERAS protocol to accept these things. So we have to make our protocol according to that neurosurgical anesthesia what we require. So this is Himanshu, there we are. You are also using ERAS in some patients. So we have to go further study. We need to have to establish this. Thank you very much. So handing over to Padmaja.
Thank you.
Hello,
thank you, Dr. Yeah. For the wonderful study. Dr. Manikandan, if you start sharing your slides, maybe we can have the first introduction slide. It gives me a great pleasure to introduce a good friend of mine, Dr. Manikandan. Dr. Manikandan is the professor and heading the division of neuroanesthesia and neurocritical care and technology at Trivandrum. And he's one of the most inspiring and neuroanesthetists who's very passionate about the work he does. And that is what makes it very inspiring. I think he's been very humble about the introduction slide. I think if I have to write his introduction slide, it would probably run much more than what he has put about himself. His main areas of interest, I think Manikandan, you have to project your introduction slide. Okay. We have the slide with us.
Yeah. Are you hearing it? Are you seeing the slides?
Not the introduction slide. Can the organizers put up the introduction slide for Dr. Manikandan?
Oh, okay. Anyway, you can tell about. Okay.
Yeah. Dr. There's his areas of interest are patient care, neurocritical care, and he's also the vice president of the Society of Neurocritical Care. And I know that he has held many posts in both SNAC and other areas, in addition to just being the vice president of neurocritical care. And he has several publications to his credit, both in the peer-reviewed journals as well as in his several book chapters that he has authored. I mean, there's lots to say about Manikandan, and this slide is a very humble version of what he is. So, coming to the topic as such, we've just heard from Dr. Joseph that neurosurgery is a shared responsibility. So, neuroanesthetist has an equal responsibility towards the patient care as the neurosurgeon. And it's, as you all know, it's a teamwork. And what the surgeon does is very important for us because most of our anesthesia is directed towards what the surgeon wants to do. And in the recent past, there have been several changes in the approaches to the neurosurgery, and a clear understanding of this is very important for the anesthesiologist to plan his neuroanesthetic management and also to anticipate the complications that we are likely to see during the procedure. So over to Manikantan about surgical approaches to the posterior fossa lesions and anesthetic considerations.
Good evening to all. Thank you, Dr. Padmaja, for a wonderful, very lengthy introduction. And I thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk. After hearing very latest advances in neurosurgery, this is something which is day in and day out being managed. That is about the posterior fossa lesions. I start from some of the basic aspects of posterior fossa and give a detailed view about how we have to proceed in a patient who is presenting for a posterior fossa lesions. My topic covers anatomical consideration, posterior fossa pathologies, surgical approaches, various aspects of anesthesia and complications in the next 30 minutes. This is a very basic anatomy. Everybody knows posterior fossa has got a boundary. On the superior aspect, we have the tentorium cerebelli. Inferiorly, the lower border is at the rim of the foramen magnum. Anteriorly, we have the clivus, and posteriorly, we have the occipital bone. The important contents are cerebellum, bilateral hemisphere, and the part of the brainstem, which contains all these important structures, including the reticular activating system, pons, medulla, and the part of the midbrain. So this is a basic anatomy which everybody should be aware. In this most other important structure, what we have seen is this is the fourth ventricle. Okay, this is the floor of fourth ventricle where pons lies. And this brainstem and cerebellum is surrounded by CSF in various cisterns. So one ventricle is present, there are surrounded by cisterns containing the CSF. This is a basic anatomy of posterior fossa. Coming to the vascular anatomy, this is very relevant for us. If you look at that, this is the side profile of the brainstem. As you look at that posteriorly, there is very limited vascular supply. This is arterial supply. The main arterial supply comes from the basilar artery, which is formed by the junction of the two vertebral arteries. So this is present mostly in the anterior aspects of the brainstem, and the cerebellum and other structures gets a blood supply via the perforators as well as branches. So the blood supply, especially arterial supply, is relatively sparse in the posterior aspect of the brainstem, whereas extensive arterial network occurs in the anterior aspect of the brainstem, which is we should be able to understand in a better way in the surgeon approach, which from the anterior or lateral or in the posterior aspect. Coming to the blood flow distribution, as you can see, this is the circle of entire circle of Willis, then two ICAs and these branches. If you look at that, concentrate on this. So what has experimental in total cerebral blood flow, experimental study was done. It's approximately around 717 ml. Of this, 20% of the blood flow only reaches the posterior circulation. Remaining 70 to 75% of the blood supply is via the carotid arteries and the extensive network of system. As you know that there is poor collateral circulation and poor blood supply compared to the supratentorial compartment into the posterior fossa. So the meaning is posterior fossa is very vulnerable for ischemia because of the lack of collaterals and lack of blood supply, low blood supply compared to the supratentorial compartments. As you can see, this is the absolute value of basilar artery is 147, is almost two-thirds of what the ICA blood flow is. Coming to the venous anatomy, in contrast to the arterial anatomy, the venous system presents mostly in the posterior aspect of the brainstem or posterior fossa. As you can see this, this is the vein of Galen joining, and then you have a lot of sinuses, we have straight sinus, then sagittal, above there will be the transverse sinus, torcula, and all these join together, and then it drains into the jugular bulb and to the jugular vein. This is the gross anatomy, superior sagittal sinus, inferior sagittal sinus. As the entire venous system, entire drainage of the brain, both supratentorial and infratentorial, goes into the posterior circuit. So this, there is a distribution of blood flow in the intracranial compartments. If you look at that, 35% of the blood only is present in the arterial compartment, whereas 65% of the blood is present in the venous compartments. And most important thing is the venous is more prone for compression. If there is any increase in the intracranial pressure or because of Mohs lesion, they can get compressed, and either the compression can occur at the intracranial level or at the extracranial level. They are vulnerable for compression. Any compression at this posterior fossa damages the venous return of the entire hemisphere. And moreover, another important point is the CSF is predominantly absorbed from the superior sagittal sinus because of the arachnoid villi. And if there is obstruction, venous obstruction here, then the absorption of CSF, normally there is a gradient of 4 millimeters between the CSF and the superior sagittal sinus. That 4 millimeter gradient is necessary for absorption of CSF. If there is venous obstruction, there is increased back pressure on these venous sinuses, then the absorption of CSF also is reduced. So this is a very important relevant point if there is a venous obstruction in the posterior fossa or either during surgery if there is any venous obstruction. Another important point which anesthesiologists remember is the vertebral venous plexus. Till now, majority of the studies have shown that the jugular vein, bilateral jugular veins are responsible for most of the venous drainage. What is found is the recent literature shows there is vertebral venous plexus around the basal area, the upper part of the cervical, as well as in the occipital area. This is most of the network is there. This is the 3D CT of one of the patients who had undergone this is a venous anatomy. You can see that extensive network was seen of venous plexus. So these are provide the alternate channels. If there is a jugular venous obstruction, they can provide alternate channels. The disadvantage or the side effect of it is that when the surgeon approaches the posterior fossa from this area or this cervical spine or upper cervical spine, this is a major cause of bleeding and it can open up. If there is a negative pressure, they can produce severe venous thromboembolism. So this is one of the important aspects of the anatomy of the posterior fossa. As I already mentioned, next important aspects of the posterior fossa is the CSF anatomy. Almost all the CSF is formed, almost 70% of the CSF is formed in the lateral ventricle, pass through the third ventricle, comes out for the floor of the fourth ventricle. Okay, and then it bathes around the brainstem and the cerebellum, and it traverses above and get absorbed, and part of the CSF goes down to the spinal canal. So there is volume of CSF in spinal canal, it's around 25 ml out of 150 ml, and the remaining 125 remains in this. If there is a, because I already told you, because of the, if there is any obstruction to the venous side or because of this brainstem outflow of the fourth ventricle here, there is a back pressure effect and the CSF pathway. So there is a hydrocephalus. So these are all very important relevant points when you are having a surgical consideration, when you are anesthetizing a patient with posterior fossa lesions. As I already told you, the volume of posterior fossa is very limited. You can see that the volume is almost like 150 to 160 ml only compared to the 1.5 3 liters of cerebral hemispheres and the entire cranium. So it is only 1/6 of the entire volume. So the volume is less, the blood supply is less, any effect on the obstruction to the venous flow or CSF affects the entire cranium, not only the posterior fossa. These are the points to be remembering. Another important point which related to posterior fossa is the intracranial compliance. As you look at that, this is one of the study in Journal of Neurosurgery from 1975. They have analyzed the compliance of different compartments of the brain. What they found that out of this 100%, 48%, almost 50% of the compliance is present only in supratentorial, because compliance means there is a lot of space in case of a tumor or in case of bleed, anything is there. There is a lot of compensatory mechanism present in the supratentorial compartment. Whereas in the infratentorial, it's the least. There is only 20% of the compliance is present in the infratentorial compartment. Spinal compartment has got 32%. So this is one of the most important relevant points. What they found out, they injected saline. This is the cisterna magna pressure, what you can see there. And this is the superior sagittal sinus pressure. As you see that when they started injecting 0.1, 0.2 ml, so as the volume increases, there is a steep raise in the cisterna magna pressure compared to the superior sagittal sinus. This is how the superior temporal compartment has got more compliance and more amenable for compensatory reserve, whereas posterior fossa has got a limited compensatory reserve. So it can produce severe ischemia of the brainstem, and it can reduce the compromise of the vascular supply. It can produce herniation syndrome. Another important point which I would like to highlight in my previous slide is, if there is any obstruction, So there is a back pressure effect on the ventricular system. So again, this compliance once beyond the compensation is comes, the ventricle system and supratentorial compartment, again, will pushes the brainstem down. So it has got a dual bad effect on this. One, if there is obstruction, it causes ischemia of the brainstem. Not only that, there is a compression from the top also downwards. So there is a brainstem is pushed both from the top as well as from the down in case of any mass lesions, acute mass lesions. So because of that, the compensatory reserve is very low, and then the severity of damage is more higher in infratentorial compartment compared to the supratentorial compartment. Coming to the pathophysiology, this again repetition, small volume compared to the contents. There is minimal space for the space occupying lesions. Compared to the supratentorial, even small lesions like 2 cm, 1 cm can have a greater impact. Whereas in supratentorial, even 5 cm, 7 cm will not have any symptomatic patients. Then compliance of the intracranial compartment, so infratentorial compartment is very poor. And then features of raised intracranial pressure are even severe, even for small lesions, because of the outflow of the fourth ventricle is blocked. So there is sudden severe increase in the intracranial pressure. And moreover, what they found, a Cushing reflex is more pronounced, as the ischemia of the brainstem is more common in infratentorial compartment compared to the supratentorial, based upon one is sudden raise, poor compliance, as well as limited collateral and vascular supply in the brain. And then most important is the densely packed vital neurostructure like respiratory center, brain, then cardiovascular centers. Many centers are located, and even the long tracts are located in a closed compartment. So the damage to the many vital structures are severe in case of posterior fossa lesions. So the relevance of clinical presentation, we should remember whenever you are dealing with the posterior fossa lesions, most of them, they have a cranial, various cranial nerve dysfunctions, except for first, second and third cranial nerves. All other cranial nerves start from the brainstem area. So it's very, very important. Then they can have altered sensorium because of the ischemia as well as presence of the affection of the reticular activating system. Then they can have various compressive symptoms. Compression includes cerebellar compression, brainstem compressions. And they can have, without any neurological, they can have purely cardiopulmonary effects. Like patient can have a poor cough, then there is a weak swallowing reflex. They can aspirate. They can have cardiovascular effects like arrhythmias, bradycardia, and hypertension. And they can have a hydrocephalus. They can have features of other features of raised intracranial pressure. And other, if there is chronic raise in the intracranial pressure, they can have a non-specific pain, especially baseline invagination, arnal caries malformation. They may not have a real neurological dysfunction. They may present only with a non-specific pain. So most important for us in the preoperative evaluation is to know whether there is a cranial nerve dysfunction, compressive symptoms, any alteration in the sensorium, and cardiopulmonary effects are present because of the lesion. There are various pathologies. Most of them comes tumors. Acute presentation can be vascular malformation, like it could be aneurysms causing subarachnoid hemorrhage, or it could be AV malformation, mostly in the cerebellar region, and then cerebellar hematoma can be there. Then various cysts can be there. Arachnoid cyst more common in the pediatric age groups. Then cranial nerve lesions like trigeminal neuralgia, facial neuralgia, hemifacial spasms, and then craniocervical abnormalities like arnal caries malformation, basilar invagination, and various congenital anomalies and mucopolysaccharidosis can affect the craniofacial, craniocervical abnormalities they can produce. So these are the, in nutshell, various posterior pathologies which you can encounter. Coming to the surgical approach, which we are very relevant, as I told you, this anteriorly we have the clivus, posteriorly the occipital bone, laterally you have the squamous part of the temporal bone. So approach, can various approaches surgeons employ for reaching the part of the brainstem. As you know that this is a very important vital structures are present. If there is a midline lesion posteriorly, if the lesion is more posterior, they approach through the occipital route. As you can see the color diagram, this is the posterior, this is the anterior part of the thing, this is the cerebellum. So surgeon approach for the inferior part of the brainstem, cervical areas or craniocervical areas as well as the cerebellum, they approach with the occipital route. If it is in the, this is the CP angle, so cerebellopontine angle. So cerebellopontine angle is usually happen, this is the, will be the mastoid, the middle ear and inner ear. So they will approach via the retromastoid suboccipital approach. If it is more higher lesion, there can be a single lesion, like either single approach can be either middle cranial fossa approach, or both middle cranial fossa and cutting the tentorium can be a combined posterior fossa approach also. That is what it can be, the transcondylar approach can also be there. Otherwise, if your lower one like jugular fossa lesion, they can use the far lateral or retrosphygmoid approach, which can refer to the jugular vein and other areas of the cranial nerves, lower cranial nerves and all. So this give you approach to the clivus, lower part of the clivus. So these are the different approaches. Based upon these different approaches, the position of the patient also differ. So that's the most important relevant point, how you have to discuss with the surgeon, what is the position which is needed, how the surgeon is going to approach the particular area of the brain. So for the midline suboccipital, commonly employed position is the prone position, and sitting also can be used in the alternatively. Retromastoid suboccipital for CP angle, commonly used is the park bench position. So we have used sitting, some of them use a sitting position also, some centers. Some of them use prone position as well as the supine with the head turn position also can be employed. And for far lateral, we can use either lateral or park bench as well. Mostly our center uses the 3/4 prone position. Sometimes we can use the lateral as well as the supine position also. For the infratentorial approach, usually the prone position is used. You can use the semi-sitting position also. If you want to both combine middle cranial fossa as well as the infratentorial, you can use either the lateral or supine depending upon the expertise of the surgeon and the team. So these are the different position being employed to approach the posterior fossa lesions. So coming to the brief about the different positions and how this modification, this is a commonly used sitting position which is employed in neurosurgical patients. So this is one of the pictures showing the approach to the suboccipital. This is the transverse sinus. This is the lower part of the brainstem and cervical region. This is how the craniectomy has been done. Dura is reflected. So patient is kept in the, with the padding, adequate padding, kept in the padding below the knee, padding below the hip. And then we have to keep arms. You can keep either side or in the front of the thing. This is the endotracheal tube coming from that. And the head is placed in the Mayfield pin holder. This is about the common. And then this is the approach which is the, from the transtentorial approach. So this is the tent. So the surgeon is trying to approach in sitting posture in the front of the cerebellum, anterior part of the brainstem. This is one of the approach sitting position. This is how the incision is made, midline suboccipital craniectomy. Patient is kept in the sitting position. So modification of pure sitting position is a semi-sitting position, where you can see there is a, the knee and legs are kept at the level of the heart. You have to know that you have to place adequate padding of all the pressure points, and the position assumptions of position should be very gradual and supine to sitting position or semi-sitting position, because there can be a lot of cardiovascular compromise can be there, especially hypotension can happen. When you are transducing, you have to keep the transducer at the level of the mastoid, so that measures the cerebral perfusion pressure. This is a picture showing a semi-sitting position with the incision for the retromastoid suboccipital craniectomy for a CP angle tumor. So your monitoring lines, so your endotracheal tube and everything should be coming from the front. It should be secured adequately. But the advantage is the anesthetist will have access to the face and other lines. Whereas in prone position or lateral position, the access may be difficult in this kind of position. Coming to the prone position, this is a simple prone position commonly employed with the bolster below the chest and below the iliac crest. And then a pillow is placed, there will be flexion at the hip, flexion at the knee. And then head is placed with the Mayfield 3/4 pin head holder. So this is how this subminimal suboccipital craniectomy can be done. Another modification is the 3/4 prone position, where either the patient can be kept turned with the pillow or bolster below one side of the thing, or the table can be tilted. So this is commonly used for far lateral approach or lateral approach to the posterior fossa. As you can see, in pure prone position, the surgeon can have an angle of only up to 60 degrees, 0 to 60 degree. If you turn the table, the patient, the surgeon can reach more lateral approach also up to 115 degrees. This is one of the modification of the prone position. Then coming to the park bench position is commonly employed for the retromastoid approach in our institute. This is how this axillary roll is kept over the dependent shoulder so that the brachial plexus is kept free, and we don't keep it over the table. The lower dependent arm is usually kept in front of it, taken away from the table and kept hanging, and then kept at the level of the shoulder tip to the heart level. And then the non-dependent arm should be kept on the side of the chest. And then a tape is kept over the shoulder too, so that angle is provided for the surgeon to operate knee here. And there can be a brachial plexus injury. You can be taking care of all these pressure points like a shoulder and then brachial plexus. And then you can see at the level of the iliac crest, then you can see the common peroneal nerve, sural nerve. And then a pillow is placed between the two legs. The upper limb is non-dependent lower limb is kept flexed, but the dependent lower limb is kept little extended, and a pillow placed between that for stabilizing the torso. So torso should be stabilized and the leg should be stabilized. Suppose in case a surgeon tries to turn the table this side, this way, there should not be movement of the trunk. This is how a park bench position should be kept. Another thing is the modified lateral, modified park bench position. It's the extreme rotation of the neck. It's a lateral position with extreme rotation, so that the face is seeing the ground. This extreme rotation can give a far lateral approach also can be given, but caution should be given because there is high risk of venous obstruction and vascular obstruction can happen, and there can be risk of facial edema and tube occlusion can also happen in this kind of patient. These are all done only in extreme cases. So various advantage and disadvantage of position sitting. The most important advantage is the field will be clear of CSF and blood, so it produces better access to the surgeon. There is limited need for suctioning and the blood loss also seems to be very limited. But the disadvantage for anesthetist is there is a high risk of hemodynamic fluctuations and there is a risk of venous air embolism in sitting position. Various other complications I will discuss later on. In prone position, it's more stable and easy for the surgeon, but the problem is it is a bad position for anesthetist because of there is anesthetist does not have access to the airway and other lines, and then the risk of venous obstruction can be high, and then there is a risk of many injuries, nerve injuries, and then it's difficult to assume, especially in an obese patient, and then the airway pressure can go up, ventilation may be difficult. So this for the anesthetist, it is not a very likable position, prone position. Lateral position, again, ease of access, very simple to turn. Again, the risk of bleeding is there. Venous obstruction can happen, especially if there is a head and neck is rotated too much. Airway related complication like endobronchial, then high airway pressure, endotracheal occlusion can happen. And then various injuries, brachial plexus injuries, pressure sores, compartment syndromes, various other nerve injuries also been reported in lateral position. So these are the advantage and disadvantages. There are so many advantages, disadvantages, and physiology also. I'm not going into details of difference of all these things because they're all beyond my topic. Thing which we have to be relevant is we have so many different positions. Some centers follow prone, some centers follow sitting, some follow both depending upon the different surgeons thing. So what is there any advantage of one position over the other? A lot of new data are coming. Earlier data was favoring in posterior fossa, sitting position is much better because it produces reduce the blood loss and improve the neurological functions. You improve the neurological outcomes, especially with related to cranial nerve. But what are the recent data shows? If you look at that, the blood loss is much less in sitting position. That still is maintained. It is blood loss or more than 300 ml is very high in horizontal. Horizontal means both prone and lateral is included in this study. So this is much higher in the blood losses in the horizontal position compared to the sitting position. So whereas intraoperative hypotension was seen more, 28% compared to 9% in the sitting position. And then venous air embolism also is very high and there is almost negligible. Earlier data shows up to 20% in the prone and lateral position. Now current data shows that venous air embolism is less than 2% in prone and lateral position because of better monitoring, better hemodynamic, better surgical techniques. So the advantages of sitting position when it comes to neurological outcome, now current one of the recent article has shown that the neurological outcome is similar in prone and sitting position, whereas the complication rates are slightly higher in sitting position compared to the prone and lateral position. Again, comparison of prone and sitting position, another article which you can see that. So surgical difficulties were more with the prone position compared to the sitting position. Again, the venous air embolism is higher in sitting position. This is in the this study is done in the pediatric patient. The earlier one which was shown in the adult patient. So this study in pediatric patient also shows that venous incidence of venous air embolism and blood transfusion is very high in and the risk of complication, as you see that other than this two complications in this study has shown that neurological complications and other complications are higher in the prone position compared to the sitting position. So some of the older studies favor a sitting position, whereas some of the newer studies shows that the complication rates are similar in sitting and prone position and lateral position. So another study in which has come in 2021, this study included over 3 decades. This is what I told you. They have compared the comparison of prone versus sitting complications. What they have found that the semi-sitting position accelerates the procedure. The surgical time was shorter in semi-sitting position. As this was associated with the reduced blood loss, but it does not significantly influence the functional outcome. So cranial nerve functions and the posterior fossa functions were similar, whether surgery was done in prone or sitting. But the duration of surgery was shorter in sitting position compared to the lateral and prone positions. So coming to the anesthetic considerations, pre-op assessment is very important, and then thorough knowledge about the lesion, about the clinical findings is important for understand how you have to monitor the patients intraoperatively, how to manage the patient intraoperatively. So mostly GCS and then sensorium, level of sensorium, associated comorbidities, features of raised intracranial pressure, and then compressive symptoms, most important is the cranial nerve and the brainstem compression should be noted, because this can be a medico-legal issues also. Then cough and gag, whether the patient have preoperative good cardiopulmonary reserve or not. Patient, some of the patient can have a sleep apnea, central sleep apnea. So patient may not himself give a history of a sleep apnea, but you have to ask the relative whether they have a history of sleep apnea is there. If the patient is having history of sleep apnea, they are excessively sensitive to sedative agents. Long acting agents should be avoided. They can have a poor post-operative functional outcomes. Then various position related issues should be documented clearly, whether patient is having preoperative deficits or neuropathies are present or any visual disturbances present in the preoperative period, and should be documented. All the investigations, including CT, MRI, should be thoroughly seen and helping in how to approach the patients. Coming to the intraoperative management, sedative premedication usually avoided. Intubation should be planned according to the airway, and then airway assessment, whether there is a patient having, especially cervical, craniocervical lesions like combination, basilar invagination, foramen magnum decompression, all this. When there is the symptoms worsens when there is a movement of neck. So in those cases, we generally perform either awake fiber optic intubation or under anesthesia fiber optic with the minimal neck movements. And then you have to see that whether the neck mobility, especially occipito cervical movement, is normal or if there is restricted. In those cases who are restricted, then you may have to undergo either video laryngoscopy or the FOB should be used. Usually flexor metallic tubes are advised. There is a risk of tube compression with the PVC tubes. Careful positioning should be done after intubation. We generally use a common approach, general anesthesia. So type of anesthesia, whether you have to use TEVA or inhalation, depends upon whether you want to go to intraoperative neuromonitoring. If you are doing an intraoperative neuromonitoring, TEVA is much better compared to the inhalation. And then we tend to avoid the nitrous oxide in all our patients. Role of osmotic diuretics. If there is no features of raised intracranial pressure, osmotic diuresis can be there, because as I already told you, there is limited compliance in the posterior fossa. So most of the osmotic diuretics reduce the brain bulk in the supratentorial compartment more compared to the infratentorial compartment. In spite of giving osmotic diuretic therapy, the patient may have still full brain and the surgeon may find it difficult. Most of the things are managed by surgeon by using either letting out CSF by EVD or by doing a preoperative shunt or by letting out CSF on the foramen magna, on the cisterna magna. So use of routine use of osmotic diuretics is still questionable in posterior fossa. And then we commonly use a mechanical pump for DVT preferences, because most of the studies are long duration. Anesthetic concession, besides routine monitoring, invasive arterial blood pressure, because of surgical process involves close to the vital centers, there is a lot of fluctuation in the hemodynamics can happen, and there is high risk of venous air embolisms. So invasive blood pressure monitoring with a CVP line insertion is usually done in most of our cases. For venous air embolism monitoring, ETCOT is mandatory, and TEE, if you have expertise, you can do it. Many times, even if you have a TEE, it may be difficult to position. If it's in sitting position, it's fine. But if it is in prone or lateral position, it may be very difficult to position the probe. So generally, we don't use in the prone and lateral. It can be used also. But mostly, we rely on ETCOT monitoring for our venous air embolism monitoring. Again, you have to monitor the airway pressure and ventilatory thing, urine output, because compartment syndrome can happen. So hourly urine output, and then intra-abdominal pressure. If it is going up, then you can monitor the intra-abdominal pressure by a bladder pressure also. Various neuromonitoring techniques we employ, SSEP, MEP, brainstem auditory evoke potential, various direct cranial nerve stimulation and monitoring also we employ during the procedure. And monitoring for blood loss. Blood loss is difficult to quantify in these patients. You should be highly aware of the blood loss, lot of blood loss, especially before the actual dura is open. This is one of the case which we have done recently. It's a child with a brainstem glioma, which you can see that it is infiltrating the pons. And then we have done the brainstem, it's a baseline value of brainstem auditory evoke potential. As you see, this is a patient had symptoms on the right side. You have unilateral weakness on the both right and upper and lower limb. What brainstem BAEP showed this, right side, the amplitude was much less compared to the left side. So there was infiltrating mostly on one of the one side of the pons. As you can see, at the end of surgery, actually, there was this amplitude improved in our case. This we have done actually today, this case. We have done this, I took a photo for showing. This is how the brainstem auditory evoke potential. These are the different waves, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Wave 3 to 7 is more important monitoring for the brainstem. It shows the integrity of the brainstem monitoring. Wave 5 is most important. As you can see, the amplitude is less in one side, and the amplitude is normal in another side. What are the intraoperative problems which can happen in the posterior fossa surgery? Mainly airway issues. Endotracheal tube can get displaced. Endotracheal tube kinking can happen because of extreme flexion or rotation of the head. In spite of you checking multiple times, still head rotation can produce airway problems. They can have a ventilatory hypoxia can be there, high ETCOT can be there. Then can be malfunctioning of lines because of the multiple tapes they put, especially central lines, they can kink or they can get displaced. So the malfunctioning of central lines, one of the problem. You have to check before and after positioning, ensure that all are all right. Then various hemodynamic problems, various changes in the blood pressure and heart rate, and various arrhythmias can happen because of the manipulation of the brainstem centers as well as the cranial nerves 5, 9, and 10. And then venous air embolism is another major problem which can happen. And then bleeding and brain bell. These are the common intraoperative problems anesthetists encounter and have to manage. So coming to the some of the brief about complication, venous air embolisms. This is one of the very old article from anesthesiology. As you see sitting, the high risk for neurosurgical patients who are having high risk for venous air embolism, sitting position, and you can see posterior fossa neck surgery are a high risk. For then again spinal fusion and cervical laminectomy or have a medium risk for venous air embolism. And the choice of monitoring is very important. As you can see, TE is one of the most sensitive for monitor for the venous air embolism. But the thing is, disadvantages, it picks up even very small bubbles. So what recent many studies, including study from Ames, what they found that when the patient is having cardiovascular compromise, like any changes in the blood pressure for hypotension or any other arrhythmias, there was a fall in the end-tidal carbon dioxide. So end-tidal carbon dioxide fall of more than 5 millimeters considered to be more sensitive and specific for a very significant venous air embolism. So a venous air embolism with the fall of ETCOT to more than 5 should give a jerk for you to be more attentive to see whether there is a concomitant cardiovascular compromise. So as you see, this article has shown that if there is moderate absorption of air, or that means 0.5 to 2 ml of per kilogram of air going, there can be ECG changes. And then if it is large, then they can have a cardiac arrest, cardiovascular and hemodynamic compromise can happen. So if you don't have TE also, no problem. We can still have a end-tidal carbon dioxide levels to monitor venous air embolism, including sitting position. So coming to the hemodynamic changes can occur at various points during intraoperative procedure. It can occur at the time of induction of anesthesia. It could be because of excessive dose of anesthetic agent. I have seen that many of our young anesthetists, young trainees, they try to prevent the hemodynamic response. They try to be on the erring side of overdose of excessive, or they administer excessive dose of inhalation anesthetic agent or intravenous agents. So many times when they change the position or during induction, there can be severe fall in the blood pressure, and because of this, there can be associated hypovolemia also may be there. So management, you can give adequate fluid loads, and then you have to give a titrated dose of anesthetic is always better. Then during positioning, again, sudden changes. So positioning of the patient should be very gradual. Sudden changes, many of these patients can have autonomic instability, especially geriatric patient, old age. They may be having coexisting beta blockers or any other vasodilators in the preoperative period. So sudden change in position causes immediate changes in the, it can cause hypotension, it can cause arrhythmias. And then again, during positioning, because of pinning, again, you give a deeper plane of anesthesia, give a lot of opioids. Again, this contributes to the hypotension. So the management should be gradual positioning, avoid the precipitating causes. You have to adequately preload the patient before positioning the patients. Excessive as I already told you, brainstem is vulnerable for ischemia. Excessive hypotension is more damaging than mild increase in the blood pressure. During craniotomy, there can be hypotension. There can be arrhythmias caused by the venous air embolism, or it could be due to loss of venous leg, venous injury, or arterial blood pressure, venous sinus injuries. So they can cause severe bleeding, and there can be raised intracranial pressure. If your head is too much rotated or flexed, again, that will be the time when there is raised intracranial pressure will be seen. And then during craniotomy, there can be a brain bulge and compression of the brainstem. This can also produce cardiovascular compromise. During tumor resection, again, the cardiovascular center is located at the floor of the fourth ventricle. Manipulation can cause hemodynamic compromise, or traction on the fifth or ninth and tenth cranial nerve can produce a trigeminal cardiac reflex or vagal reflex. And also they found that there is excessive cerebellar retraction also causes severe hypotension. This is also one of the causes when the surgeon retracts the cerebellum too much. So treatment is avoid pressure. Excessive traction should not be there. Immediately inform the surgeon to release the traction on the vital structures. That is the only treatment for it. At the end of surgery, patient can have a hemodynamic hypertension can be there. Or this could be because of seizures. It could be because of pneumocephalus. Or if you could not corrected the fluid status properly, again, the patient can have a hemodynamic disturbance at the end of surgeries. These are the various causes and the timing of hemodynamic changes which can happen during surgeries. This is one of the cases which we recently did, a CP angle tumor. As you can see that throughout the procedure, till the surgeon was during dissection of tumor, the blood pressure was maintained around 99 by systolic by 67. But when there was sudden increase in the blood pressure, then when we found that when we were trying to evaluate the cause, we got the same time we could see that we had put the neuromonitoring. So there was a traction on the trigeminal nerve. You can see that there is a common motion action potential at the masseter. So we found that there was a traction on the trigeminal nerve near the gasserian ganglia, near the tent. Surgeon was operating. So we could correlate this high sudden increase in the blood pressure is because of the traction on trigeminal nerve. We informed the surgeon and it came down like that. This is how we need to correlate the different changes with respect to the hemodynamic position. Again, coming to the complications, we come to the post-operative complications. Complications mostly related to the positions. So nerve injuries are quite common. These are various articles have written. So brachial plexus, this is a close injury claims of in some article come from anesthesia analgesia. On it does not include only neurosurgery, it includes multiple surgeries, neurosurgery, orthopedic surgery, cardiovascular surgery, including obstetrics and gynecology. The common nerve injuries which are reported include the brachial plexus injuries, then ulnar, or more common. So, and the common reason why this kind of injury is found that position related problems are constituted around 30% of the time, and then 40% of the time you cannot find a reason for why the nerve injury happened. So I told you pre-existing neuropathy is one of the reasons, especially diabetes and other things. We should document all those things to further prevent the medical legal issues which can happen. Coming to the postoperative complications, seizure is quite common. Even though it is infratentorial, seizures is more common in this one of the earlier studies from the AIIMS. This is from AIIMS. It came in 1989 from neurosurgery department. The incidence of postoperative seizure highest in patient with acoustic schwannomas, almost 9%, followed by medulloblastomas and astrocytomas. Various risk factors, what found the sitting position, venous air embolisms, and pneumonic phallus. All these were found to be risk factors for postoperative seizures in infratentorial surgeries. Another most important unique complication is the tension pneumonic phallus, especially occurs when the patient is in the posterior fossa, when surgeon does not feel adequately or let out too much of CSF during surgery, or the surgery is done in sitting position. This is the Mount Fuji sign. So pneumonic phallus or pneumoventricle can happen, as you can see in this picture. If it is tension, this can be associated with the various complication. It can be a life-threatening complication also. Patient usually present with a headache, or can be delayed awakening, or seizures can happen in this. The treatment is strict bed rest and head elevation. If there is a tension pneumonic phallus causing cardiovascular compromise, then you have to put a twist drill and let out the air. So first, so in the overall incidence in sitting position is found to be tension pneumonic phallus found to be 96% for pneumonic phallus. Tension pneumonic phallus was seen in 4% in a study, recent study in ACTA neurochirurgia. And the cause, excessive CSF drainage, head up position commonly employed, excessive dehydration for brain edema, hyperventilation, use of nitrous oxide. These are all one of the risk factors for the tension pneumonic phallus. Again, other risk factors include advanced age, male, long surgeries, and semi-sitting process. Macroglycemia is another important complications, extremely important. Recently, we had one similar complication in one of our patients, which we had to go for an emergency tracheostomy. In spite of having a bougie, we tried to extubate the patient. It was not very severe, but we could not thread the tube over it because we had to, one surgery was done in for a posterior fossa. We had used a flexometallic. At the end of surgery, we wanted to ventilate the patient. So we tried to exchange with the airway exchanger, but we could not thread the thing because there was severe macroglycemia, and the surgeon has fused the cervical. There was a occipital cervical fusion with the rods. So extreme caution is needed whenever you are dealing with this kind of patient. This common cause for this is the regional venous drainage block. If there is an obstruction of the venous flow, there can be, or the lymphatic flow, there can be facial edema, there can be macroglycemia. Again, there can be laryngeal edema as well. So various checklists should be used. So factors which risk factors for macroglycemia include previous history of head and neck radiosurgery, any patient who had a preoperative chemotherapy treatment, which most of our patients may have had. Obesity is one of the risk factors, and prolonged duration of surgery and position all are the risk factors for the macroglycemia formation. One of the things which are advised is the use of cleft endotracheal tube, or on avoid placing severe hard bite blocks or TE probes or oral airways. All those things are high risk for occurrence of macroglycemia. You should try to avoid all those things. Again, care should be given for proper positioning of the head and neck. Postoperative pulmonary complication. This is again another study from Girijarath from AIIMS. They found in 12% of the patient, the infratentorial surgery had a postoperative pulmonary complications. The risk preoperative risk for factors were lower cranial palsy, and intraoperative lot of blood transfusion was associated with the postoperative pulmonary complication. Another study found that risk factors for postoperative tracheostomy in patient with infratentorial surgeries, they are young age, if the patient is having preoperative swallowing difficulty or cough, lower cranial palsies, and certain tumors infiltrating brainstem like astrocytoma, ependymoma, they are at high risk for postoperative laryngeal problems, and tracheostomy may be warranted in these kind of patients. Again, another dreadful complications, mostly reported in prone position in spine surgery, very rarely reported in infratentorial fossa tumors. I could not get a reference for it, but still we should remember that postoperative visual loss, even though if it is rare, it can happen. As you can see in this graph, this is the intraocular pressure. Over a period of time, the intraocular pressure goes up, and the ocular perfusion pressure, this is the pink line, which comes down. So it can produce ischemia of the optic nerve and can produce various postoperative visual loss. This is another study which has found what are the common cause of visual disturbance. Most common is the corneal aberrations. So it is extremely important to, as you can see, like almost 44% occur in the perioperative period. So corneal aberration, injury to the cornea, it could be because of the dryness or because of exposure keratitis, which can happen if the patient is having facial nerve palsy preoperatively, or if the patient is kept in prone without pins, if it is put in the horseshoe or any other harnesses for keeping the head rest. So there can be corneal aberration, which should be avoided at all costs. Again, ischemia of the optic neuropathy. It can be either anterior ischemic optic neuropathy or posterior. Posterior is more dreadful, it produces complete blindness, whereas anterior has got a better prognosis. This can happen, mostly has been reported in spine surgeries, including lumbar spine, has not been reported in posterior fossa surgeries. Again, cortical blindness can happen, and retinal artery occlusions can also happen. As you see that all these have been reported in various spine surgeries. To come to the conclusion, so management of posterior fossa is very challenging for anesthesiologists. It requires proper planning. It's a teamwork. And then at almost all the costs, we have to prevent the complication which can increase the morbidity and mortality in these patients. So a great care is needed for managing this kind of patient. It is not an easy task, even though many times it seems to be looking easy, but it should be understanding what are the problems which patient can face during the entire course perioperative period. And then a proper workup should be needed for the success of the anesthesia and surgery in these patients. Thank you for giving the opportunity and for the patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Manikantan, for extensively covering this topic very succinctly. We have a couple of questions for the speakers. For Dr. Srilatha, I think some of them have been answered in the chat box, but still probably for the benefit of the others. What is the ideal temperature for the irrigation fluid, and is a central line required for all endoscopic procedures, is the question for you. Dr. Srilatha, would you like to take that?
Yes, ma'am. The first question, the ringus lactate is at a temperature of 36 to 37 degrees centigrade is optimal for... Coming to the central lines, CVP is not mandatory for all neurosurgical procedures. But in cases like if you're going for pituitary surgery, mainly in the intraoperative and postoperative monitoring, the patients may land up with DI. So CVP monitoring may be useful for those group of patients.
Thank you, Smith. And to Dr. Joseph Monteiro, the question was, how do we manage the complications, postoperative complications in these patients where ERAS is planned?
Complications, anything specific?
The question was, how do we manage the postoperative complications in patients who have been discharged early?
So I think I'll come back to what I was saying earlier, that discharging the patient early is a thing that is a part of the ERAS protocol. However, I myself, in our institution, we don't have the ERAS patients being done on a short stay basis yet. So even our awake craniotomy is monitored overnight in the ICU. So my point is, in Bombay, specifically for my own hospital, getting a bed on a day-to-day basis for a routine elective procedure is extremely difficult. So hence, discharging a patient and getting readmitted is near to impossible with the Bombay traffic. So I suggest that we don't discharge a patient so soon. And if you come back, probably the patient will be admitted in the casualty and taken up from there, depending upon the complication you speak of. Despite all protocols, nausea, vomiting is a distressing symptom. And seizures is another problem. So probably prophylactic use of anti-seizure medication and continuing in the post-operative period. Preventing complications is much more important than treating them. Like most things, prevention is better than cure. So I think you err on the side of safety, and if in case of any doubt, try not to discharge a patient early.
Yeah, I think these are the things that are still barriers for application of ERAS in neuro-MC. So, I mean, my question is like, how far do you think in India we have been able to achieve this ERAS as compared to the rest of the world?
In India, okay. So I think I am also thinking of whether there's a little bit of a cultural issue here. So probably abroad, the healthcare is governed by the insurance companies. And so they want to see high turnover and quick discharge of the patient and using that bed for the next patient as soon as possible. Fortunately, unfortunately, that situation has not yet reached us. So the side of safety. And the next thing is also the importance of having a setup socially where the patient can be discharged to. So in our hospital also, if you discharge a patient, many of our patients are referred patients from out of the city and out of the state. So then probably they have to be discharged first to a close by hotel or such facility. So I think in India, it will take some time. And as those review articles and especially Himanshu's article says, probably multi-centric trials in big institutions are required before we venture into it. It's a good thing to happen, and but I think we should err on the side of caution right now.
Totally agree with you. And there is a couple of questions for Dr. Manikandan, probably more general relating to neuroanesthesia. What do we do if there is bradycardia? Give atropine or discontinue the procedure or stop the surgical stimulus? And also, on what is the ideal fluid for neurosurgical procedures?
It's a very difficult question. See, we generally tell the surgeon to stop the stimulus. That is, it is for during ETV. Is there? I am seeing some two, three things. One is where should the pulse oximetry be placed on dependent or non-dependent hand in the lateral position? What we do is we place the pulse oximeter and the non-dependent hand, and then some other centers put the arterial and on the dependent hand. So in our center, we use both arterial and pulse oximeter, both on the non-dependent hand. But we require a continuous, once the patient is positioned and surgery is happening, any ischemia, we cannot turn the, we cannot modify anything in the position. The surgeon will be operating. So we want more safety about the ventilation. So pulse oximeter and arterial end, we generally put on the non-dependent hand. There are some centers which put arterial end on the dependent and pulse oximeter on the non-dependent. It depends upon the practice. Second thing, fluid, choice of fluid is, we generally give different, in my, even my department, many people give different, follow different regimes. We generally give, we should not give excessive, I don't know whether you mean the post-operative visual loss, excessive crystalloid and associated with post-operative visual loss, especially in sign surgery. And you should not hemodilute too much. One of the important points to prevent the complications. We use ample amount of colloids, and then we give alternative ringer lactate and normosaline. And some give only normosaline. It's for short surgeries like 2 hour, 3 hour, they don't use ringer lactate as well. So sometimes we use two normosaline and one, like 1 liter of normosaline and half liter of lactate ringer or like that. So different people follow different, there is no ideal fluid. Only thing, you should not produce too much of hypotonic fluids. Hyposmotic fluids should not be given, which can worsen the cerebral edema. One more question about hypertension during intracranial aneurysm. We generally try to give a 20% above the baseline. We try to maintain during aneurysm clipping. We generally don't control the blood pressure too much. If at all hypertension occurs, we deepen the anesthesia, or we give more opioids or dexmed. Can be alternative. We don't give back active blood pressure reduction in the any intracranial aneurysm clipping or coiling.
Yeah, if the organizers permit, we have some pioneers and stalwarts in neuroanesthesia in the audience. Can I request Dr. Dash, Dr. Nidhi, Dr. Zulfikar, Dr. Himangi, and also Madam Bibu Kalyani, Madam, to offer their comments?
Yeah, they can. Absolutely no problem. They can. They can contribute. Hello.
Hello. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Haridhar.
Yeah, I mean, my sincere thanks to ICA, particularly Dr. Radhakrishnan and Dr. Jayasri for organizing such excellent neuroanesthesia symposium. And all the speakers spoke very well. And the topics are also of very good quality. Thank you very much.
Dr. Nithi, Dr.
Dr. Dash, I think my question would be towards you. Where do you see IRAS going in India?
Hello, say it again.
How do you see IRAS being implemented in India?
The future of IRAS in India.
Yeah, I think the society should take an active role in organizing experts, and we can. There is no problem.
And also to the seniors who have seen the progress of endoscopic procedures, there was an initial enthusiasm about CSF-like fluids, but somehow now it seems to have died off. Any reason why there is why it has gone down again?
What?
There was an initial enthusiasm about CSF-like fluids for irrigation in neuroendoscopy a decade back, but now we don't see the enthusiasm.
Yeah, that's true.
Any reason why it has gone down?
No, I think normal saline is good enough. And why to go? I mean, of course, the research has to be carried out to find out the exact CSF. And the other thing is normal saline, there is no problem absolutely. And it is very cheap and easily available. That may be the reason.
Actually, it is the amount of fluid. It is not the type like normal saline, our sir said, this is quite okay. And what is important is the amount of fluid. And the exit tract should be very good, so that there will not be intestinal hypertension. That is the thing. And about IRAS, we have to have more randomized study. Then, and it is, should be, the protocol should be individualized for in each of the procedures. So IRAS for craniotomy should be different. IRAS for the spine surgery should be different, because we have to have the analgesic, the sedative, the use of monitoring, minimum monitoring in this thing, and so we should not have this avoidance of postoperative nausea, vomiting, epilepsy, and all these things, seizures, nausea, vomiting, and these have to be individualized with the patient. And about the feeding protocol and the protocol for nothing for mouth, how long it is not as it is for the other surgeries. So we have to, and our patients are on drugs, so that one patient is under anti-epileptic drugs, so we should not avoid that. So we have to give during the operation also one dose of that. So these are individualized. So our neuroanesthesia needs more study in our setup. That is the thing, what I think it should be.
That means IRAS is not getting popularized in neuropsychical work, or?
No, and to have it popularized, we have to have more studies to establish that. That it is, whether it is helpful or it is like what we practice now. So, and our patients are from far from village. One patient has come, so we cannot discharge the patient early. So that is the thing, because they will go home, which is far away from our center. So if there is any thing happens, they cannot come to us. So when they come, then there will be, they have to be readmitted, and things will be and the stay will be more then. So what we have to have this stay, prolonged stay, we have to avoid. In ERAS protocol, we have to, the hospital stay should be minimized. So, and all the patient can go to the society, like the pre-operative, how he was or she was. So these things are very, I mean, in neurosurgery, it is the type of surgery. So it have to be individualized for all types of surgery.
The present scenario, you think it's not possible to accommodate ERAS in neurosurgical work because you don't want to have acute discharge of the patient. Because why I say is ERAS is getting more popular in orthopedic work, more in obstetric work. And again, gastrosurgical work, ERAS is getting more popular day and by. Probably because these days, after a major abdominal surgery, on third day, they like to push the patient out. Anyway, the transport problem is going to be there in India, wherever we are. But probably people who are near and dear to hospital, probably they could go, say, after third day, they can get back to their accommodation over the home, and they can come back immediately. But if they are beyond 20 kilometers, well, India, well, I cannot think about.
Yeah, I suppose neurosurgery definitely over the decade has become much safer and also shorter. So probably we can look forward to ERAS in the coming few years.
That is the thing. We can look forward, but that's what I said. We need more studies, more randomized controlled studies in our setup in India. So there should be more studies in different aspects of neurosurgery, different types of neurosurgery. Then we can do it for
may
everything.
I,
like
may I add my experience, madam?
Doctor, I don't have any experience.
Yeah, Dr. Hemang here. Can I add my own experience over here?
Yes, please.
We started using this ERAS protocols in neurosurgery about 3 years ago. As Dr. Montero said, that our aim was not an early discharge. All patients were admitted, and by using these protocols, we didn't want to discharge them early, but we wanted them to be back to the health little earlier than what it would have been without that. So we started following the protocols and all in our own way. Few things, as Dr. Himanshu Prabhakar said, that the glucose, carbohydrate loading and all those things were little bit adjusted for neuro. And to see the effect, we also checked how the patient felt. We used the quality of recovery, that 15 question, well, QOR 15, and saw that how the patients are feeling. And we found something interesting, that the patients are feeling better when we are using the less of opioids and we are not using the pre-medications like the midazolam, then the early recovery is there. One thing interesting is no patient went on ventilator because of hypothermia, because we started monitoring and managing the things. The moment we saw the patient first, the patients went on hematinics and like that. So the blood usage also, I won't say that we have analyzed and it has reduced or so, but then overall things were better, overall outcomes were better, but we have not yet analyzed and we are just happy with what we are doing and we are continuing. So probably rather than looking at early discharge, their well-being and number of ventilators, on-table extubations, probably those might be the different outcomes that we can study in neurosurgery.
So we have to modify what is the module of ERAS in other cases. We have to modify our module.
Right.
So what Hemangi and all are they doing, it is very, because we are practicing some of them, like the scalp block and like your interscalene block and all this, for the pain relief after the surgery of the spinal surgery. So these are we are doing, but we are not saying that it is ERAS protocol. So we have to modify our protocol. We have to modify. We should aim at what Hemangi said, that we should aim at not early discharge, but less complications and less ICU days, like that, less ventilator days. So that is very nice work you are doing. So we'd also go ahead for ERAS, but we have to modify our ERAS protocol.
I have a short question to Dr. Srilada. Well, either Srilada or Dr. Manikandan can answer. The question is simple. In endoscopic cranial work, what sort of pressure maintenance you like, whether you like normal tension or modified hypertension or say hypotension, which one you like? I mean, it's a 25% below or above the normal. Which one is most suited for an endoscopic cranial work?
Endoscopic cranial?
Work. Any endoscopic cranial surgery. Endoscopic cranial surgery, which you are discussing, nasopharyngeal or say transcranial, whichever, or posterior, or say any of these particular endoscopic work, what sort of pressure is the ideal?
So usually we maintain, go for normotensive surgeries, sir, because controlled hypotension is usually avoided in endoscopic neuro procedures. We go for normotensive. And other than that, in aneurysm surgeries, yeah, you go for hypertensive, like around 20% increase in the pressures. So we usually advocate for that.
This so-called deliberate hypotension, which was a fashion years back, is it followed anywhere now?
No, sir, we don't follow.
No, no.
Not followed.
Nobody follows these days. No. Okay, no. Yeah.
Actually, it is the cerebral perfusion pressure. See, the pediatric. So you have to have more of, more like 60 millimeter. But in pediatric, you can go for 40. So it is the CPP, which is more important during your surgery. It is.
Even when practicing deliberate hypotension, we always look at the CPP. We like to have the CPP within the control. Yeah.
Yes.
But anyway, that rather passionate approach towards deliberate hypotension, I doubt, is present these days in anywhere. Okay, everybody likes to go with the normal tension. Yeah.
It's always normal tension. Yeah. Normal. Oxia and normothermia. So you have to go for that all the time.
Yeah, that's what I was referring to. Yeah.
Manikantan, there's one last question on transcranial Doppler in neurosurgery intraoperatively. I thought you were very passionate about TCD. So,
before that, I want to ask one thing, sir. We are asking about this induced hypotension. There is one area where we give minimal hypotension is AVM surgeries. We do a lot of AVM surgeries. After, if you keep a normal tension, there is a post-operatively that can have severe cerebral edema or bleeding. We deliberately reduce by 10% so that there is, because the vessels will be very, does not have auto-regulation. This is one condition where still we give sodium nitroprusside in the post-operative period. So up to 24 to 48 hours, so that there is no reperfusion, hemorrhage or edema. That is one thing which the one unique thing in the brain AVMs surgeries, especially surgeries. So regarding the transcranial Doppler, I think Dr. Srilada has already answered this thing. As you were told, we are using for various bypass procedures. We are using for aneurysm surgeries intraoperatively. See, we are using, there are two types of things. One, we are using in the from the beginning of surgery, after anesthesia induction, baseline, we check autoregulation, everything. And we have an intraoperative Doppler probe, which is a 16 megahertz probe. It will be put by the surgeons. Now, our endoscopic pituitary surgeon is using for pituitary surgery also. Whenever there is a tumor, is very close to the ICA, to identify the ICA, to ICA flow. The Doppler, intracranial Doppler, is used very widely nowadays in multiple surgeries. For AVMs, we are using. For after bypass, we see check the cross circulation and flow. And for after clipping, we see that parenchymal artery and distal artery flow. So these are some of the uses of transcranial Doppler intraoperatively for various neurosurgical procedures. Again, postoperatively, we use for multiple things. For intraoperative, we use this intraoperative probes for any vascular areas, lesions. And we use a lot of intraoperative ultrasound. Our surgeons use a lot of intraoperative ultrasound to see the tumor, extent of tumor, location. Then they see that whether after a resection, any issues there, all those things.
I'll thank the organizers for giving us this extra time from 9 to 9:30 to have this wonderful discussion. And also thank you for giving us this opportunity to have this session on neuroanesthesia. May I request Dr. Baljeet Singh to give his vote of thanks and conclude the talk.
Thank you so much, Dr. Padmaja. Well, friends, that was neuroanesthesia module 2. These were excellent presentations and by all the speakers. But before I go to all the speakers to thank them, I must thank the moderators of the program, Dr. Padmaja Durga, well, ever humble, a very polite person, an accomplished teacher from Nizam's Institute, and Dr. Bibu Kalyani Das, another very senior neuroanesthesiologist from the Institute of Neurosciences, Kolkata. One of the flag bearers, along with Dr. H.S. Dash, of thank you so much, both the moderators for an excellent moderation of the whole program and the selection of the topics as well. Coming to the speakers, Dr. Srilada spoke on the anesthetic considerations of neuroendoscopic procedures. Well, she justified that endoscopic procedure is minimal for the anesthesiologist. It may be minimal for the patient with smaller incision, quick recovery, perhaps early discharge as well. But for a neuroanesthesiologist, I think there's nothing minor. It may be okay for the surgeon and for the patient as well. Dr. Montero spoke on enhanced recovery of surgery. He put points in favor and against quoting various studies. I think ERAS probably will have some more years before it gets a firm place in neuroanesthesia, in the field of neuroanesthesia. And I like the statement that you said, for better to come, good must stand aside. So let's see in the coming years, what stands aside and what comes better. Professor Manikandan from Sri Chitra spoke about the surgical approaches to posterior fossa and their implications. And I think he justified very well that it's very important for neuroanesthetists as well as the surgeon to sit together and discuss and plan the surgery so that both of them are on the same field. I think this is the best for the patient outcome. To discuss and to share each other's viewpoints. And friends, I also thank all the participants who participated in the deliberations, the discussion. There were a few questions asked, and the speakers gave very scientific answers to all those the questions that made the discussion very, very lively. So thanks to all those who participated in that, and of course all the attendees who were there who participated in the whole program. Thank you so much on behalf of the president of Indian College of Anesthesiologists and the whole executive of ICA. I thank everyone, and before I go, I think I must thank Dr. Sneesh as well, who has been doing it for a number of weeks together. Every week he is putting the whole act together. Thank you, Dr. Sneesh. Your contribution to these webinars is tremendous. So in the end, thanks everyone. And with this, we come to the close of this webinar. Thank you so much and good night.